It's the Opie and Anthony show. Yeah. Opie took off. He had to go. He was swollen.
Yeah.
He was definitely taking on a Rocky Dennis look.
It's not like Jim gets swollen on the show.
No, his eye was swollen.
It was a different type of swollen. Jimmy gets swollen when there's certain girls in the studio.
This was his face, and he's supposed to go to a doctor.
Yeah.
So we have to figure out how to turn the music down now. Because Stumpbrain's
Stumpbrain.
And Michael Chiklis is in, and already Bob Kelly is asking questions that he's wrong.
Yeah, because it was on the prep sheet. Whenever we get a prep sheet, Michael, I got to apologize. I don't know who puts it together, but it's completely wrong.
Well, you know,
and why would his mic work?
Hold on. His mic working?
We have no one knows what we're doing here.
Here I am.
There you go.
Well, you know, they probably went to IMDb and looked it up because, you know, according to IMDb, I have a house in Greece and I speak three languages.
You do?
Oh, really?
Yeah, I'm really happy about that.
You really do?
No.
I'm kidding.
No.
I'm kidding. What am I, that good of an actor?
Do you,
everybody?
Do you look at some of the stuff on the web and just go, oh, my God, what are these people? Why are they bothering?
Yeah, sometimes, man. That's crazy. You know, look. I don't know where they get things. I don't know. I guess people talk, and it's weird. They must sit around campfires and make stuff
Yeah,
up.
Make it all up. And the more successful you've gotten, I mean, the Shield really put you over the top. That just, I mean, from season one, people were really digging that show. It was a whole new type of, except for regular cable, HBO, movies like that, you didn't see that on
Basic cable. Way. Absolutely.
So you guys really kind of broke it open for shows like Rescue Me and other shows where they, Nip Tuck. I mean, that hard language where you're like, did I just hear that?
Yeah, right, exactly.
You know, was there any concern when you went into it that there's going to be problems?
Well, you know, my first question is, are we going to do this? Really? Yeah, like, because if the pink pages come down on the first day of shooting and it's like a boiled version of this, I quit. I don't want to do it.
Right, right.
But if we're going to do this, I'm in. And Peter Lagori and Kevin Riley, who were heading up FX at that time, went, no, man, we're either going to fall on our asses or we're going to do really well.
That at least,
the pink pages, by the way, are the rewrites.
Yeah, exactly. Jimmy, thank you. Jimmy, a fellow actor.
So people know that, you know, you see a great script and all of a sudden the next day the pink ones are written.
It stinks, yeah, and then they take all the teeth out of it.
Yeah, right. That happened to me.
Yeah, that's why it was. That's why it was pretty unique to see something like that, you know.
Yeah, it was crazy. As a matter of fact, they just said, look, you only have this much money to shoot it. You only have this much time to shoot it, but go.
Yeah.
You know, and hey, we were cool with that.
You know what's cool about it is it wasn't some big budget show.
No.
But it had that realism, the grit to it and stuff that.
Well, you know, innovation, you have to make do with what you have.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact is that's one of the reasons why we shot it the way we did. We made it look like a docudrama because, you know, we had two cameras and a butt dolly. We didn't even have a proper dolly. We have something called a skate dolly, which is like an octagonal board with some like roller skate wheels
on it. Bumpier than
that. So we just thought, you know, Clark Johnson's brilliant cat, man. He directed the pilot. You know who Clark is, right?
Mm-hmm.
From Homicide: Life on the Street, and you know he directed SWAT, and he's really amazing talent. In any case, he directed the pilot, and he wanted, you know, the camera to be like another person in the room.
Right.
And he created this sort of docudrama look, which makes it really visceral. It makes you feel like you're in the room with us. You know?
Yeah.
And it's a very cool way to shoot a show.
The I guess the whole show's wrapping up, though, huh?
Yeah, this is it. 7 seasons. I can't
Amazing.
Believe it.
Amazing, 7.
Yeah, you know, time flies when you're having fun, man.
Yeah.
We had a great time shooting this show. It was really life-changing for all of us. Tremendous amount of attention. We, you know, essentially created a network, changed some things up in the business. And, you know, it's cool to be kind of part of something historic like that. But, and also I'm kind of spoiled because I've been playing Vic Mackey for 7 years. It's not every day you get a role like that, you know, and, so I'm kind of like looking at stuff and going, really? Really? But I will say I got lucky. I got this cool little part in this Spielberg movie. He produced this movie called Eagle Eye.
Eagle Eye, right.
Now, yeah, and it's very cool movie. And Shia LaBeouf is, he's the real thing, man. The kid's cool. He's a very cool
guy. What's the gist of the movie?
This is the, oh, God, this is the movie that I've seen promoed in IMAX.
Yeah, man. It's heavy.
That looks fantastic, where it's, you have 30 seconds to leave the room. Like, awful, creepy call
right,
voice.
Exactly. Well, you know, you'll never look at your cell phone or your computers or, you know, your credit cards the same way again.
I heard him in an interview. The CIA guys were there.
Yeah.
And they were like, can you really do all the stuff they do in the movie? And they played him back a phone call he had on his cell phone from a couple days before. They just recorded it.
There's some yeah. See, but he's been around the campfire. He's making stuff up.
I didn't say that. Shyla said that in an interview.
You're making it
I
up.
Swear to God, I don't lie.
Jimmy lies.
Wait,
all
you said that?
I'm a Catholic.
Bobby lies all the time.
Shia LaBeouf said it on an interview yesterday.
Yeah, well, actually, some of it was really cool. Is I played the Secretary of Defense in the movie, and we shot at the Pentagon.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and, you know, it was trippy.
That's got to be a little rough to get the permits to do that.
Yeah, check it out. I actually flew in and landed on the green of the Pentagon in a Black Hawk helicopter in post-9/11
cool
America.
Was that?
Unbelievably cool. We're walking around the bowels of the Pentagon. I turned to this 5-star general and I said, General, you got to tell me, how did this happen? And he said, to tell you the truth, it almost didn't. We weren't going to let this happen. And I thought, God damn it, this is an American film crew in America wanting to shoot an American film.
Mm-hmm.
Why the can't we do this? You know, and he made it happen. And I applauded the guy. I was like, way to go, man. That's cool.
It's funny how sometimes if you get some whatever, a little bit of celebrity, or as you have a lot of bit of celebrity, how people will kind of cut you some slack. It's like, hey, you want to see the room where we keep the real films of the Kennedy assassination?
You know, it's amazing. Yeah. I felt like, George C. Scott in Doctor Strange. He's going to see the big board. You know, we went into that room. We went into the room where they, like, you know, they plan attacks in. You know, it's insane. And it's funky. You walk in there and you have a cell phone. I hear this voice. And it's the computer. It knew that I had a cell phone in my pocket, and I had to take my cell phone out and leave it at the door.
Damn.
You know, it's weird.
And there are some iffy pictures on it.
Yeah.
Photos of your own genitals.
Speaking of celebrity weirdness, we walked in, and, you know, when you come in, you have to show a picture license, you know, or ID to come into the Pentagon, and these hardcore Marines up there, and everybody in the cast and crew that's walking in there is pulling out their wallets, and I started to pull it out, and I hear Vic Mackey is in the house. and I look up, and the Marine's like, you, sir, do not need any photo ID. Come with me.
Thank you. You're walking. Like, peel off the rubber mask.
Exactly.
I've gotten in.
It was very, very cool. You know, that's one of the coolest things about being an actor is things like that.
Yeah.
To do.
Like, why am I here? I don't belong here.
Yeah, I know. Exactly. Someone's going to you always feel like you're going to, and believe me, I'm not trying to equate myself on any level with celebrity, but you do realize.
Neither am I.
Bobby. But you do. It is an odd thing how people do kind of give you that little leeway or, hey,
yeah,
I listen, you know.
Really?
Yes, Jimmy.
No, I'm actually agreeing with you.
Another thing is you've had really good success with your career coming from a spot where you were told by certain reviewers that you'd never work again.
Have you ever
seen some of those people?
I need
people?
To clarify something. It wasn't reviewers. It was the
business?
The power of the business. It was worse.
What happened?
Know?
That was when did
it's just
Wired.
The first 20 years ago now. You know,
I did
my first movie, I landed in this movie called Wired, you know, which was based on a book by Bob Woodward. And, you know, it just was a controversial mess. And I understand.
You play Belushi, right?
Yeah. I understand the reasons why, you know, I mean, Bob Woodward's an investigative reporter. And when he writes, he doesn't write with sort of flowery, forgiving language. He writes, you know, this happened, this happened, this happened. And in black and white, it doesn't sound very good. You know what I mean? And it reads very much as an indictment against the people who are around Belushi, as if they were somehow complicit in his death. And
right.
I can understand in retrospect why everybody was so mad, you know, and you know, listen, I
it's got to be a certain amount of vindication.
I can't
though.
Believe I'm still talking about this 20 years
no,
later.
No, I know. The only reason I bring it up is that you've had such great success after that. So it's almost like I know me personally. I'd be like, hey, screw you.
You know what? I'm glad I didn't. I fought that instinct, really. I think that's the single biggest reason why that I did survive it was mm-hmm. I didn't fight. And I just went, you know what? This is a lot bigger than me. It has nothing to do with me. If I throw my hat in the fray here, I'm going to get my head chopped off. I'm just going to work. I just want to. You know,
like I said, it's 20 years.
I just want to work.
Yeah. It's 20 years ago. You know? You just want to do something.
Well,
and
plus, you know, I was coming from the place that Belushi was an idol of mine. I love mm-hmm. that cat. You know, I didn't want to hurt anybody. I wanted to play this guy. I loved him.
Yeah, everyone
you know?
Did. I mean,
well, yeah. Or and by the way, you know, or it was, can I tell you the specials for this evening? You know, I was waiting tables.
Yeah, exactly.
It's 23.
man.
Play Belushi, wait tables. Huh.
What restaurant was it at?
Different mindset.
Formerly Joe's on West 4th Street in the Village. It's no longer.
That restaurant's doing. It's not around anymore?
No, apparently.
You made the right decision.
Yeah, I think I did.
And by the way, can I call myself out? Like when you said you were in the Pentagon and I said, like, yeah, you don't belong there. Like, what am I doing here? That was an implication that I have been in similar circumstances. I just, what a phony I am. I was booted off the set of Two Girls, One Cup. I'm credentials. I'm a fraud.
Oh, great.
You know, but your career, though, I mean, you played so many different, you played the commish, then Curly from Three Stooges, which is a hard gig.
That's a tough one.
That
man.
Was a tough gig.
You know, especially being from Massachusetts, and you know, you're from Medford. Yeah. You know, we're hardcore Stooges fans, and Curly was God.
It.
You know, honestly, a good
stunk.
Day. Tell me if I'm lying. A good day after school was when you came home and there were two Curlys and a Shemp.
Oh, yeah.
If it, that was like, oh, yeah, a good day. If it was like two Curly Joes, you wanted to kill yourself.
Oh, if you saw like, wah, 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 and you went, oh, Shemp. Or Curly Joe Besser.
Yeah.
Shemp.
With old.
I like Shemp, too, but that
Shemp was good.
No.
When the Stooges started getting old, though, and it was like, I think they're going to hurt themselves. It started making some movies, and Moe's hair was all gray.
Yeah, Moe's hair actually came off.
Yeah. You know, so it was, you know, when you play someone like that, an iconic guy, you know, like Curly, you know, it was pressure, absolutely. But I just, I felt really good about it because I threw myself at it. And you know what? We shot that in Sydney, Australia. Have you guys ever been there? Uh-uh. Go. Mm-hmm. Are you single?
It's the only place I want to go, like, out of this country right now is Australia.
I'm not single, but I'll throw this ring out a window for a good whorehouse any day. How much is it?
Wow.
Is our money good over there?
Are there a lot of girls over there as per guys or something?
Yeah, it's very overweighted in that way. Yeah. I mean, it's just a beautiful place. It's unbelievable. It really is. The only problem is it's so damn far away. But the Australians are cool people, man. They're really laid back. Because anything that goes wrong, the first thing out of their mouth is, no worries, mate. It's the first thing they say. You know, so they're like, well, we'll fix it. You know, you're like, okay, cool.
You never saw an Australian guy just snap?
No.
Just lose his mind? What are you doing? This stinks. Forget it. I'm out.
No.
Never.
What are you doing?
And then there's like thousands of miles between the cities, too, aren't there? Like, it's not like you can just go from Sydney to some other city without getting on a plane like doing a New York to L.A. or something.
Yeah, everybody is on the outer rim of this continent.
Yeah, because the middle is just the outback, I guess. It's nothingness.
Well, in the middle, it's a desert. There's nothing.
Did you go out and do any of those, you know, little walkabout?
we went into what they refer to as the outback, but their Grand Canyon.
Oh, okay.
It was incredibly funky. We were in this all-terrain vehicle and not like an SUV like you see this was like, you know, the Bush mobile for 3 hours on no road. And I was so sick as a dog by the time I got out of that car, because you're like,
just beat up.
Just killed. And we got out of the thing. It was beautiful. But the guy's telling us there's like 190 different kinds of venomous snake.
Oh, fantastic, yeah.
You know, I mean, you didn't want to...
No worries, mate. One,
yeah, it's like, nah, watch out for the vipers, mate. I'm like, you know, so you just don't even want to walk away from them at all. I'm like, hold me. Yeah. It was crazy, crazy.
Well, Michael Chiklis, I know we got to get you out of here, but what do we got? Eagle Eye?
Yeah, man.
Is that an IMAX now? I really wanted to see that. I had no idea.
Let's go see it today.
DJ Caruso is one of the most brilliant directors in the world today. He just knocks it out of the park. It's an unbelievable movie. Shia is unreal in it. You know, Billy Bob
He's
awesome. You know, Rosario and Michelle Monaghan. It's a great cast. A really, really good movie.
And when is that? Is that out now?
26th.
26th. And, of course, The Shield.
Yeah.
Final season. Any little insight you could give us on anything? What's going to happen? How this is going to wrap up without ruining anything?
Well, you know, put it this way: it's the last season, so stuff happens that you can't take back.
I think people are going to be hurt. I think some people are going to be hurt.
Stuff happens that you can't.
Oh, okay. All right, that's good.
Please tell me you did something just to do it, like because you knew it was ending, like in the last episode. He comes out of the closet and they
No.
Like a Broadway chorus thing. Yeah. And then people are like, what is that?
No, it's like, so.
That sucks.
Show is so good.
Freeze, Buster. No, that doesn't happen.
Oh, God. Well, look for that. When's that starting up?
It already did, dude.
Oh, it did? Okay.
We're in week three.
Week three?
Yeah, stay with me.
I told you that.
I DVD everything.
Yeah. But I will tell you, though, really honestly, the last seven episodes of The Shield, I'm more proud of than anything I've ever done in my career. I think particularly the last seven of the best shows I've ever produced. Yeah, I hate to talk stuff, but I'm telling you, it's so well written. The performances are really strong. Every single one ends with a, "Oh, you got to be
kidding me!" You got to be kidding me!
What? You know, and a lot of action. You know, it's like a freight train.
That's cool.
Really good. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm so psyched, dude. You know why, too? Because you're like my hero because you're famous, you're a star. And
I'm bald.
Yes. Like, you know, when I lost my hair, I was like, it's done. I'm done in the business. And then you came
along.
Your
talent was attached to it.
Hey. I knew that was a softball. There was just so many things that anything could stick
to. Hey, we could put our heads together and make an ass of ourselves.
But no, you're right. Dude, bald guys, you never, what are you going to do? I mean, you can't play like
Billy Zane lost
Jack or your kid. There's nothing you can really do.
Name him.
Daddy Warbucks.
Name him.
What?
Well, you go back and play a lot of things, now. Man. Billy Zane became bald and he was out.
Yeah.
Black people, a lot of black bald famous guys.
They look great bald.
True.
Well, great. I'd love to talk about
Chicks
this all day.
Big bald. You know that.
They do.
We got to take a break. Get Michael out of here. Michael, thanks so much for coming in. Eagle Eye.
Shield is on now, and Eagle Eye, I really want to see this movie, especially in IMAX, man. It's September 26th, which is a week from today, and season 7 is on FX, Tuesdays at 10 o'clock.
Groovy.
Very good, Michael. Thanks so much, man.
Thanks for calling the Opie and Anthony FU line. Here's the latest batch of FUs.
You have 5 new voice messages. First voice message.
Yeah, I'd like to give a big F you out to my girlfriend and a punk ass boyfriend.
Next message.
I want to give a big F you to my boss, Brian, who's always making me work late and smelling his wife's tampon.
Next message.
Yeah, I just want to give a big F you to our dispatcher, Trish. All she does is us every night we're on all day. Call after call after call. I don't care if people call 911. Call someone else, you.
Next message.
Hi, this is Ryan. I want to leave a big you to Drew, this douche I work with. This is the second time he's me in 2 days. Now I'm stuck down in the middle of God knows where with the wrong keys to the building that he told me to grab. You, Drew. You.
Next message.
I just wanted to give a big you to all my girlfriends. I don't even know why I hang out with you bitches. You guys are the fakest people I know. So you.
End of new messages.
Call the Opie and Anthony FU line. 866-FU-LINE-1. That's 866-FU-LINE-1.
Thank you and goodbye.
Ooh, this is a little mellow. Hi. Opie and Anthony show. Wow, we got to go right to the phone. Celebrities just love the Opie and Anthony show. Ricky Gervais. Yes. Ricky, yes. Hi.
You know, I love being a celebrity.
Well, you are one.
Yeah, that's right.
Now movies and everything.
Hey, Ricky, how much is
your mic? Why would Jimmy's mic be on?
Is that shouting without their microphone turned up?
Jimmy Norton.
Jim Norton, you might remember me. We've met a couple. If you saw my face, you'd remember me. I was talking to you with Louis C.K.
Yeah, I know who you are. I remember your face. How could I forget that face?
Okay.
It's like, yes, I know who you are.
I didn't know.
I've already passed it on to a surgeon I know.
If you forget what his face looks like, just look at your knee.
That's Bob Kelly. You might remember him if you saw the cutting room floor of Ghost Town or Dane Cook's new movie.
Our movie's going to be big. I'm excited about our movie, Ricky.
Our movie.
We've had lovely reviews, haven't we?
Yeah. Getting really great reviews,
almost
man.
Almost 80% on Rotten Tomatoes so far, which is phenomenal.
That's great. That's brilliant. I like being 80%.
You were hilarious on Conan the other night, too, making him bend down on his knees, taking photos of him his own show.
I can't believe he did it.
Twice. You made him do it twice.
A grown man in a suit. He's about 6'6". He doesn't need to do it. He spent a long time on his hair. The last thing he wants to do is crawl around a carpet.
He's got that Bob's Big Boy hair.
I know. It's good. It's got a hell of a bounce to it.
Yeah.
Hey, how much, an extras is another great thing you did. And how much, Andy Millman, is it for real when you start hitting big? Like, you kind of starting out like, ugh, and then all of a sudden you're just rocketing into fame. Is there any of the truth in that?
I'm leaving town. Now the reviews are good, I'm leaving town. I've actually got to go to the Emmys. I'm leaving today to get ready for the Emmys. I'm handing out an Emmy, and obviously I'm going to lose about seven. I'm going to have my name not called about seven times.
Oh, no.
On Sunday.
What are you nominated for, sir?
I think director, writer, actor, producer.
What are you, Jewish?
Greedy.
Some are for extras and some are for the American office. But I'm going to... Also, they've put me in the film category, which is a nice promotion, but I'm up against four Oscar winners.
What are you up... What in the film category?
Well, I'm up in the extras special is actually in the movie category.
Oh.
They've put it in the movie category because it was like 85 minutes long, which is nice and it is flattering. And we sort of secretly made a movie. I was sort of practicing. But then to be put up, I'm up against, you know, ridiculous actors, real actors. So I've got
real actors.
Who are you up against? Because I mean...
Ralph Fiennes, Paul Giamatti.
I pardon you.
Wilkinson. Just ridiculous.
They all stink. I'm tired of all of them. You got a great shot at winning. Who wants to see Ralph Fiennes again? It's like, we get it.
He was great. Have you seen Bruges? It's brilliant.
No, but I'm just kind of being partisan because I like you so much.
Well, yeah. Well, I still want me to win more than them. As much as I like them, if I'm pitted against someone, then I want me to win. For example, you know, even if I like you guys, but if we were in maybe a gladiator arena,
right,
and it was a battle to the death, I'd have to try my hardest.
You'd have to kill us. Are you going to try to look gracious when you lose? Are you going to like clap and smile like, "Oh, I'm glad he won"?
Now, are we in the gladiator arena now, or just the Emmys?
Ricky, please. If you lose one, the first one you lose, please on camera just mouth the words to someone. He sucks. How did he win? He sucks. Because they'll go to you every time.
I know. You've got the choice. You either can clap and really pretend that you want them to win, which is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Right, that's ridiculous. You can sort of clap and sort of smile, and that's good, okay. Or you sort of whisper to the person next to you just for something to do.
Yeah, yeah.
Like you're just getting on with your life.
And then everyone's speculating, like, what's he whispering? I bet he's, like, pissed.
Yeah, I like it when they really are surprised.
I always assume that if you're there at the award show, and you're nominated, you want to win. So you're not clapping and happy that somebody else won.
Of course you want to win.
Yeah.
Of course you do. I mean, I actually do go to award shows more than I do other things like this because it would be a slap in the face not to. Unless I genuinely can't go, particularly something as big as the Emmys or the Globes and things like that. So I always try and go, but of course you want to win.
Yeah.
It's the only times when I'm torn. I thought Steve should have won the BAFTA because he was up against me and he was more the comedy character, so there I thought it genuinely probably would have been better to Steve to win because, you know, he's nothing without me. Steve. And it would be a nice little... Do you know what I mean?
Steve Merchant, you mean?
Consistently, I'm let down by my cast. I keep proving that I'm what keeps everything afloat. And to be honest, I think I'm carrying Ghost Town, in all, if we're being... totally honest. There was one construction worker that was like a string of them. They looked like you know, have you seen Village People now? They look like that.
Yeah, I've seen the cowboy walking around or something. But
yeah, with his open chat. Yeah.
remember the day where you were getting chased in the park down that hill through the underneath the bridge?
Yeah,
I got yelled at by the director that day.
Why, what did he say?
Because you were on set?
No, we were running down the hill, and I was a little heavier at the time.
Right. Oh, did he? No, I think when he shouted, run, fatty, he was talking to me.
No, I was running down the hill, and my arms started flailing and making circles, and I just ran by the camera with my arms like propellers, and people were laughing, and I was like, oh, my God, I just did something funny in the movie, and then all you hear is him go, why did he do that with his arms? And
then, yeah, no, but he said to me, he said, you didn't look fat. He said you looked camp.
Well, he actually walked up. He goes, why did you do that? I go, I'm fat. And I walked away.
Which is the answer for every question.
Yeah. Was.
Yeah. That's what I say. It's a disease now. Everything's a disease. I have no responsibility over this. I like to eat too much because my brain kicks in and says, eat that. And there's nothing I can do about it.
Yeah, no one takes responsibility for anything anymore. You could just blame it on a disease, get a prescription for it.
Well, I talk about this on the new podcast we've got out. That I said, there's now with no political correctness, you see, that's gone crazy, there's no stigma at all. And I was saying, I want people to shout me in the street, fatty. And the papers picked up on that. All the British press are going, call Ricky fatty in the street. And I wanted to make it clear that I meant all fat people should be abused.
Right, not just you.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, on your podcast, I think they're number 1 through 5 on iTunes now.
I know. Yeah, I know.
Yeah, they're huge.
We've been 1 to 4 for about 2 years now, and this new one's come out, and it's gone straight to number 1. So eventually I want to push everyone out the top 10, so it's just my chart.
Just you selfish bastard.
It's like when there's a pop band in, like, Eastern Europe that's at number 1 for 19 years, because it's the only homegrown pop band. That's what I want to be like.
So now, obviously, the reviews are coming in for Ghost Town. Very good. Now, what have you gotten a lot of offers coming in now, more movies?
Well, do you know what? It hasn't really changed because, I mean, apart from this one, I've been turning down everything anyway for about 5 years. And I haven't been turning down films because they weren't good or they weren't right for me. It's just been a no because I've been busy. You know, I did The Office. I worked on that for 3 years, then extras. And I just wasn't looking. And I'm still not looking because I'm doing my own thing. The next film that's out is This Side of the Truth, which I just finished writing and directing with Matt Robinson. And that's me and Rob Lowe, Jennifer Garner, Jonah Hill, Christopher Guest, Jeffrey Tambor, Tina Fey. It is like the comedy cast of the decade, you know, and so that's very exciting.
And now you're part of that whole inner circle. Oh, my God.
Well, I'm not really part of any circle. You know what I mean? You're the only people that consistently invite me into your world. Everyone else just does it once and then says, let's just rest.
Let's rest. We've talked a little too much, I think.
What's that new movie about, This Side of the Truth?
It's imagine if the world was different. Imagine if the human race hadn't evolved the gene for lying. What would it be like? There'd be no fiction, no art. Everyone would be brutally honest. And it's a very harsh world. I come along and I'm a loser in this world and I'm beaten up by the world. But I discover I've got this genetic mutation and I can lie. And so I'm pretty invincible and I can get anything I want.
Damn good
that's
idea.
A great idea.
Ricky, Jesus. Ricky, can I tell you something?
Go on.
I auditioned for that too.
Did you?
The guy standing on the thing screaming.
Oh, yeah, the guy, the crazy guy. Yeah.
Would you leave Ricky alone and stop following him around to auditions?
I didn't even know.
I didn't. Where did you audition? In New York.
Yeah, and I got a nice hot no. I got, thanks.
No, you'd be good for that. You'd have been good for that. I mean, the guy we got was good. I'm gonna admit that to you. I mean, we're happy with what we've got in the can.
But it would have been different.
And I didn't know you then, did I? I could, in the future, I'll pull a few strings.
It seems like movies would be your thing because you kind of don't like staying on any one project too long, it seems.
Yeah, movies are great because you sort of treat the work slightly differently. Not that I don't do this for television, but movies really are forever. And it seems like you might as well, you know, really get them right because you want them to be around. Like Ghost Town, you know, it's a little movie, but what I think is nice about it isn't the opening weekend. The fact that I think it's like a little perennial classic.
Mm-hmm.
I think this, you know, this will play for 20 years, hopefully. And me and Steve Merchant were very conscious of that. And I think it's because I came to it maybe with an older, wiser, fatter head on my shoulders. And, you know, we always thought we took out jokes that you wouldn't get in a year's time because they were a cultural reference.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Because, you know, we think that. And I think it still stands up. I know it's only been 5 years, but I think it'll be around in 20.
There's nothing worse than watching a movie that it was a kind of a good movie that just has references in it like, oh, brother, yeah. What
yeah,
are
exactly.
you doing?
A Big Brother winners reference. People yeah. Say, well, who's that?
Yeah.
It was Craig. I don't remember Craig.
You have this great knack for, like, you really are the quintessential not greedy with comedy. Like, you did 12 episodes of The Office. A phenomenal finishing 2-hour special, whatever it was, and you were done. And the same thing with extras. It's like you never, you always finish. Like people really want you to do another season or whatever. You never get greedy with this stuff.
Well, there's a few reasons for that. I mean, I've been let down myself. I hate this idea that if something's successful, you've got to milk it. I don't know why you've got to milk it. That's for other people, not for you. I don't know why that it's them thinking, you know, that they're sort of milking you, not literally, that would be disgusting. And the other reason is, you know, you do get bored quite quickly. But the main reason is that because me and Steve do it all ourselves, we haven't got a team of 20 creative producers. We don't use other writers. We put everything into it. It takes us months and months to write the scripts. Then we film it. And then we worry about the font on the back of the DVD. And it's really intense.
Jeez, yeah.
So, you know, but the payback is the fact that we can put it on our shelf and say we did that. And that's the most satisfying thing, the sheer pleasure of having done it.
Mm-hmm. It's funny, too. Everyone tries to get these cringe moments in comedy. And you by far and away are the master of just uncomfortability.
Being
and
a douche.
But I mean, like, where you really physically recoil watching when you're alone. And in extras, I think the moment that got me the most was when you're at the awards show and the doll of you is giving that awful, you have it a laugh, that horrible catchphrase. And the guy is trying to give this touching speech. And it's just,
Oh, yeah.
Well, great, man.
Well, that I mean, I've always been aware of uncomfortable moments, but I've never got embarrassed myself. I mean, you guys are the same. I think that we've got, like, this sort of shield, particularly if you're a comedian. But I feel discomfort for other people. And the worst thing for me is a bad sense of humour. If there's a group of people and someone makes a joke and someone else, and then someone makes a bad joke and it goes badly, I want to rewind time and go to him, don't say it this time.
No.
And I don't know why. I feel sorry for the coolest man in the world if he can't tell a joke. I feel sorry for a president. If he makes a bad joke, I want to go, oh, bless him. He could be bombing the shit out of countries. But if he makes a bad joke, I'm still so sorry for him.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's something very revealing and there's something totally naked about somebody in a social setting who is trying to be funny and it just gets a zero and there's that cold stammering after. Ooh. And people just kind of look down at
you can't drips. Look at each other.
It
yeah, it's
hurts,
just
doesn't it? It actually
oh,
hurts.
Oh, pain. Yes,
like
physical
feel,
pain.
Oh, you want to breathe deeply. Just, oh, you can't shake it off. Embarrassment. I mean, it's just the worst.
He just reached out for love and everyone in the group went, no, we're rejecting you. It's a very personal thing.
Yeah.
I was at this dinner party once with them. We only knew sort of one set of friends, and they were all their friends. And they were quite sort of like ranging from sort of like the posh and middle class and up to sort of like 70-year-olds. And we were telling jokes, and we got onto, like, you know, sicker jokes. And I told one particularly, I won't tell it now, I can't. It's really sick. And they went on. And then at the dinner, they said, oh, tell that joke. And
oh, my God.
I went, no, and I went, oh, go on, it'd be all right. And I looked around, and I thought, well, okay, it must be really cool. And I told the joke, and it went quiet, and they went, not that one. Well, be specific. I just told the worst joke in the world.
Yeah, we embrace our bombs here on the show.
Oh, they're fun, aren't they? But that was the fun with The Office. The Office was actually And we didn't say this at the time, but The Office was a comedy about comedy. It was much more about comedy than anything else, really, because in a social situation, that's what people try and fail at. That's what, you know, and it's just, it is the worst. It's the worst feeling in the world to bomb with a joke.
Well, the beauty of David Brent was, it was so, how, like, completely, he would go, oh, he gets it, he's having a laugh. Like, you would always point at people who were just deadpanning.
Absolutely.
And go, he's enjoying it.
Completely unaware at what an ass he is.
Also, of course, because he had that added pressure that he knew it was being filmed, so he had to be seen to be doing well. Because that's what he wanted it for.
The little eye dart off to the camera.
Exactly.
Like, looking over at the camera like that, remember, all uncomfortably.
Well, I remember when we were making the show, I mean, we were such a slave to the realism. But more, we had to keep reminding people that it was a fake documentary. Because if you take that away, it's quite an average, boring sort of sitcom where nothing happens. But when you realize that these people, well, particularly David Brent, is doing it because he wants to be famous, it adds the, you know, the biggest dimension.
Yeah.
And then when you see why Tim and Dawn are sort of being coy, it's because they're being filmed. It makes it you know, all the frisson comes to life, and it's so important.
That's a great point, yeah, because if you just take it at face value.
Yeah,
I wouldn't even know what to make of it at face value. It might be funny, but when you do put it in that documentary atmosphere. Yeah.
I think it would be depressing. More depressing than that.
Depressing.
It would just be people that there's no reason why they're
with horrible jobs and a horrible boss.
I know, exactly.
And the way David Brent would sell himself, the beauty of it was in those moments where you're talking to the camera, and just the things like, I want to be, if they say, hey, he's a great boss, well, you know, sue me. Just these little things you'd say about yourself. It's like, God, what an ass.
I know. Well, a couple of the, I mean, the people say, is it based on anyone? And it's sort of a Frankenstein of people I've met. But one of the, you know, the opening scene where I'm saying to that forklift driver, you know, I don't give bad jobs. If a guy comes to me and I make the phone call, that actually happened to me when I was about 18. I went along to one of those temp agencies to get, you know, to be placed for like weeks in factories and stuff when I was, before I went to college. And he gave me that speech, and he called up the guy and he goes, of course they're over 21, and sort of winked at us like we were sort of meant to be happy that he was lying to a friend. Like this is meant to ingratiate you. So you know, they're all sort of you know, out of experiences. But I think the more real something is, even if you just do it on a subliminal level, the more payback you get. And I just think people identify with it more.
I think that's great when you can remember some, like, one moment of someone being a complete ass from years ago in your life.
Yeah, I suppose I've always been a sort of, you know, people watcher, and it sort of goes in, yeah.
Will you get the same reaction from, like, people who are watching your work that people get in real life when they do that thing? And I think that's the hardest part to translate, is, like, you can make me uncomfortable while I'm alone watching it, which is really hard to do.
Well, the only time I get it, apart from Curb Your Enthusiasm, which I get that with, I sometimes have to turn away because it's just too much. Where it's slightly different with him because he's sort of, like, defiantly like that. And
yeah.
Like David Brent, who had the blind spot. The Larry David character in the show is one of those people that won't back down, which is funny. But the times I get it, apart from social situations, is the reality game shows. Two people flirting on a reality game show honestly makes me want to cut my own head off. There is nothing worse. When they think they can't be heard and he's sort of like doing these lines, it makes, oh my God. It's just nothing more about, and someone singing a song. You get these people going to Big Brother or what, and they want to be a pop star. So they sort of like singing songs all the time as well as they can. And you want to go, it's so cringy, isn't it?
I love the fact that you probably induce more cringe than anybody, yet it bothers you so much when you actually see it for yourself.
Because mine is fictional. This is what we do. We create these superheroes and villains so no one really gets hurt. Whereas these people are real. They're really doing it.
It is true, though. I hate when you're walking through New York and someone's just, see some dude just singing like some Broadway song. Because he's, you know, he's an actor and he wants people to know that he sings. Ugh.
Oh, I quite feel sorry for those actors that are dressed as teddy bears giving out leaflets, though, because they wanted to be playing Chekhov at the National, but someone going, you know.
we were just talking to Michael Chiklis, and he, you know, did the whole stint as a waiter. That's kind of the stereotypical what does an actor do before he makes it thing.
I think that's better, though.
Yeah?
I think it's better to work in a bar or be a waiter than do a, you know, dress up.
Yeah,
then,
yeah.
Oh, you know, I just, oh, God.
Just try to get your 15 minutes and hope it lasts longer.
Because everyone's got a mobile phone with a video, and it'll be on YouTube. When you're the biggest star in the world, you'll get on YouTube, and you'll be clucking around like a chicken, handing out leaflets. Yeah.
Dressed like a piece of gum hanging out Wrigley's.
You're right. It's too. There's a great moment too in Extras that I love so much. It's like it's such an honest way of capturing. Like Andy Millman's an extra, and then he starts to hit big. You know, getting his own sitcom.
Yeah.
And in season two, and you go to this little bar, and your fans are annoying you. So then you go to this fancy place where they put you in the special VIP area, and they boot you out.
Yeah.
Oh God, who was it that showed up? The singer. Oh my God,
David Bowie.
David Bowie.
Well, that happened to me. My girlfriend was a producer on a big English soap opera called EastEnders. You know, it was, we went along with some of those stars, right, when she was working there. We went there, and they let us do in the VIP just like that. They let us sit there, and then they came over and said, "You're going to have to move." We said, "Why?" I said, "Because Goldie Hawn's just come in."
Oof.
And they moved these soap opera stars out of the way for Goldie Hawn to sit there.
What year was it? 1979? Who cares about her?
1969.
It was like, no, about 1992. She was over in England. I don't know what she was doing. So it actually happened. But the David Bowie thing was sort of like that. I mean, obviously, I couldn't be accepted where I wanted to be, so I went back and got a little bit of... adoration and from the idiots. Yeah.
Yeah, but this at the end of the episode, he goes
back to the small bar.
But there's something really touching about that. It's like, well, these guys are really human. These people, it's like you don't feel like they're caricatures. There's something really touching about these guys because they're these zeros that like want to be loved and just they.
Well, I think that's true. But I think if you scratch an actor or an actress, just a little bit, you'll see something bad that's happened to them, and they really want a hug, and they really need love, and it's just, not all of them, but even the ones you think are all right, you know, that they can turn on a sixpence, they can suddenly start shouting about their cappuccino being cold, and I'm always scared when I meet someone, like, are they going to be normal? And, you know, everyone I've met so far has been pretty sort of, like, stable, and I suppose that it's the ones with talent that are okay.
Guess he didn't talk to Bobby that long, huh? On the set.
I'm in his movie, okay?
Yeah, no, he's...
Let's be serious.
Actually, you know what? I'm still thinking him sitting there with a hard hat on, and he obviously isn't, is he?
No. Can't, a flesh-colored one.
Well, he was actually at the Cellar with Louis, and I took a nice hot bombing. I really wanted to do well in front of Ricky.
You didn't bomb. Why did you think you bombed?
I heard both of you giggling when I wasn't talking.
Oh, why did you think you bombed?
No, there's a reason for that. Because Louis said to me he forgot to mention his therapist. And I sort of laughed because of Louis pointing out where you'd gone wrong. You were doing the thing.
Where I've gone wrong.
Yeah. I thought that was what I was laughing at. I thought that I was laughing at the audacity of Louis during a set to lean over to me and go, he forgot to mention his therapist. Where you were doing a bit about, I think, like, and that's what I laughed at. We weren't sitting there laughing, going, look at the fat, bald guy without a crack helmet on dying.
Yeah.
Ricky, we got to kind of cut it short and get out of here. Yeah, we got to go to the XM side and curse.
Thank you very much.
Hold on, Ghost Town is out. It does come out today.
Yeah.
But mention it every day for a week. We need to stay around in cinemas. We're only in about 7.
We'll do that.
We have been talking
about
it.
We're your pal.
He was kidding, Jimmy.
No, I know. I realized that as I committed to start saying, and then I'm like, do I want to be the idiot that didn't get it, or do I want to act like I'm really professional?
Yeah, multi-million dollar movie, 7 theaters.
Yes.
Yeah. Like, 2 in Jersey.
Or multi-million, not multi-million. You're a multi-talented guy.
Thank you.
Bob, you idiot. And numbers 1 through 5 on iTunes. And what can you say? The original Office and the Extras. Hey, good luck at the Emmys, man. I really, really hope you beat all those finished bums. I really
And thanks for calling in and stuff.
We were having a few issues,
and Jimmy was a little upset. But I'm glad you called it. No, not at you, of course.
I'm going to try and pop in next time I'm here as well.
Yeah, when you're in town, just
excellent.
You know.
I'll talk about you on my blog today, RickyGervais.com. I'll talk about the Oprah Anthony Show and all my friends in New York as I leave the city.
Very good. Thanks, Ricky.
Take it easy, Ricky.
Good luck, man.
Later, man.
Bye.
Ah, there we go. What fun.
What a fun caller, man.
I know. He's fantastic. And you can't help but just, like, dump adulation on the guy. Because, he's too good.
Because it's great. Everything he's done, I've watched. And I've felt really sad at times and laughed. It's like, God damn it, I'm such a fanboy.
And how does that, like you said, you're sitting alone. Oh. You're watching him in two dimensions, and you're just, you're cringing.
So you've seen the original Lost?
Oh, hell yeah. Okay. It's fantastic.
You got into it after a while, right?
Yeah, like, yeah. He's a complete douche.
Yeah, but he's such a nice guy in person. He could totally be a dink if he wanted to. But he's just a sweetheart.
Played it off like he does on the shows. He'd be an ass.
Yeah, what a sweetheart.
Friendless.
And I'm hug him.
I'm sorry, guys. I apologize.
No, that's okay, Jimmy. We'll head over to the light side.
I have tickets on sale for Boston, third and final show.
Get three?
November first two sold out. November 15th, the Wilbur Theater.
Can't sell out one.
You're screaming at me.
Sorry.
And also, of course, the highlight of... we do have on the XM series, XM side, we have Dane Cook calling in to explain why Bob has been completely humiliated in acts. And of course, Michael K. Williams, finally!
Yes.
Omar from The Wire, he is in promoting the new Spike Lee film and another film he has coming.
Can I plug a date, Jimmy?
Please.
Anthony?
Yeah, what are you asking Jimmy for?
So I know, I changed it up, right? It really does just go to Anthony.
No, it doesn't. Believe me, it doesn't.
October 24th, I will be at the Wilbur Theater in Boston, the new Comedy Connection. Tickets are on Ticketmaster or WilburTheater.com. So if you, if Jimmy doesn't do seven more shows, feel free to come by one of mine. You know, Bill Blumenthal's like, Jimmy, selfish. Three shows.
Right, look, we got to get out of here. So we'll see you over at the satellite side. Have a good weekend for those of you not joining us. A bye-bye. That familiar music can only mean one thing.
Yes.
We're still doing this.
Yep.
Yeah. Opie and Anthony Show. Sirius XM Satellite Edition, which means we can now speak openly. If someone's being a shithead, they can be called a shithead.
How about a
we don't have
cunt.
To say duty head. Ah, that's a little too far, Bobby. That's a little too far.
Fuck twat.
It's okay. The C word I like to say for maybe 5 minutes in. Let the people that initially tune into the program think we actually might have a show instead of just we come on here and curse.
We've had a good show so far.
Yes.
It's all shit to me, though, from before this. We had Michael Chiklis came in, Ricky Gervais, great call-in. We love Ricky.
Yeah.
And Dane's calling in a little while. Fantastic. But Michael Williams.
Yes. Michael Williams joining us from The Wire.
Ooh. I cannot be fucking happier.
Man, thank you. Thank you for calling me down.
Omar.
I cannot be. I've never wanted to get a guest in. Maybe Ozzy Osbourne is the only comparable guest to me to get in. You are a hard guy to get in studio. It was just a lot of stuff that was going wrong, and we were trying for a long time.
Apparently, he was a busy guy, too.
Yeah, trying to pay them bills.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, he's in the new Spike Lee movie.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Come Miracle at St. Anna's, which I saw. And there's another movie you're doing too, right?
I got The Road coming out, the new Cormac McCarthy book. That'll be out on my birthday, actually, in November. And then I got Brooklyn's Finest with that Fuqua directed. And I got to be opposite two of my mentors, Don Cheadle and Wesley Snipes.
Don Cheadle's great.
Phenomenal.
Yeah.
I just saw his movie Traitor the other
day. Man.
When you went to call me to go see that movie, I was in Traitor that day.
There's a guy that climbed from like just kind of a peripheral player to a fucking star, you know? The guy Hotel Rwanda was like, wow.
Man, I've been following Don since Devil in Blue Dress.
Really?
Yeah, he kind of popped on my radar. Since then.
His performance in Boogie Nights was great.
Amazing.
I mean,
that whole
you
movie
know,
was great.
No, yeah, the movie, the whole movie was fantastic. Yeah,
favorite,
and he didn't have a huge part in it, but it was just like when he's at that bank, just going, please,
bank,
can you, please, I just need that. You're like, oh, god damn.
You're not being fair.
Yeah.
Like, that's such a childlike thing to say to an adult. Basic reaction. You're not being fair.
You're not being fair. This is not fair.
This is not fair. I could do this. I want to open my
his
stereo store.
His electronic stereo store.
Him and his big dick and his fucking
going
career.
You know what I mean?
And his cowboy outfit.
When the murder happened in the diner. The sheer look of fear in his face with his hands up, like, and the blood splatter.
You saw that cash laying there?
What?
And his awful fake dreads that he had, that fucking dread wig at the party. My favorite moment is just sitting there with those shitty dreads trying to look intense.
I believe that was on the New Year's Eve party, right?
Yes.
The dreads,
it's a fantastic. And then you see him in, like, Hotel Rwanda and stuff. It's just fantastic, you know, really.
I bugged out on him on the first day at rehearsal because I went on this whole tangent about Talk to Me and the Petey Green story, and I was doing all the, I'm Petey Green.
Oh, the radio.
The radio guy.
Haven't seen that. I heard it was great.
Oh, God, you got to see it. It's off the fucking hook. But so I like kind of embarrassed myself the first time.
That's good. Like when I walked in, I'm a fanboy too. Like when I see somebody I like, I see him talking to Master Poe. And I'm like, is Master Poe fucking hassling him coming in?
Nah, you got to respect the senseis, you know what I mean?
Big Master
my sensei back in Jersey.
Are you a martial artist?
I'm not a martial artist. I'm getting my butt kicked in the dojo right now. That's what I'm
working
at.
I'm
working on my Wesley Snipes, but I ain't nowhere near there. But I train up there in Union.
How long have you been taking it?
About 3 months now.
Oh, you just started. Okay.
I'm sore as shit.
Oh, so yeah, you're at that phase.
What are you taking?
Karate, and it's karate mixed with boxing.
Opaque belt?
No, I am no belt right
no
now.
No belt? They don't give you a belt?
Bro, I'm still trying to stretch to get my leg up.
Really?
Yeah.
I took karate once, and then I split my gi because I was too fat, so I quit.
Nah, man, don't quit.
Good for karate.
You know how hard it is to split a gi?
I don't think it's ever been done before.
Never.
Well, hey, you're in the Guinness World Book now.
Twice.
Now, we come in here, you're a nice soft-spoken guy and everything, but now on The Wire, how did you get that where did that badass come from?
That ain't me. That ain't me. See, we have a rule on The Wire. If your phone goes off, it's $25. If it goes off while we're filming, that's $50.
All right.
You got to get them. You got to get
That's a pretty good one. Opie would owe a lot of money.
Yeah.
We all would. We bought a playground in Baltimore with the money we made from that. We built a little basketball court for the kids in the hood. But I just pretty much, I knew the character came written the way it was. There was nothing much for me to add. So I knew I wanted to just make him sound like a Baltimorean. I didn't want him to sound like a kid from Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
I knew I didn't want him to look like a kid from New York dressing like that. I immediately saw that Baltimore got their own swagger. So I would spend hours in the street and just listen and watch the comings and the goings. I got to watch, you know, girl go in the morning and boy come out. For those who don't know, that's crack and dope. You know, crack goes in the morning, dope comes out.
I swear to God, I thought it was some kind of a tranny reference.
Of course you did.
I swear to God.
You were hoping.
Boy or girl is coke and dope.
Okay.
Really?
I would watch the streets. I would watch the streets. I would listen. I would sit in the Lexington Market for hours and just listen to dialects and people's tones. And, you know, with the help of David and Ed and the directors they brought out, it just kind of came together. And I went to the shooting gallery, which is the roof of my old projects in Brooklyn. And
really?
You know, yeah, I had to learn how to, because you know, I didn't want to do the whole, the Hollywood thing with the gun.
Yeah.
You know, I never really shot a gun before Omar. So I want to know what would it look like for a guy my frame to hold a big ass gun. So I went to the shooting gallery in my hood on my, with my building. I had to learn how to bust a gun for a little bit. You know what I mean? But,
yeah, those are fun.
Yeah,
believe me, I'm an avid collector.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
So you must have loved the scene in season 3 when Omar and Brother Muzon had that little gun conversation.
I'm not up to season 3. Yeah, no. No. I was one of the last one to get into the wire. But like, you know, in this day and age, I like doing the 48-hour film festival where you sit there and just keep putting DVDs
That's
in.
That's the way to do it,
though. Oh, man, no commercials,
no
nothing.
Commercials.
You're sitting there, your eyes are red, drinking a beer. What?
To-go containers everywhere.
Yeah. One more, and then you're like, just one more episode, man. One. It's like, I'm definitely going to sleep after this one. And then they end it in a way where it's like, well, fuck, now I gotta watch at least the beginning of it, and then before you know it, it's over.
You start out watching it, you're fully clothed, but then you just have one sock half on.
Please. Tipping off the tip to your toes.
I tell people, like, who just now, where people, I meet people in the street, and they're like, yo, I just bought the whole 5 seasons, and we're gonna watch it. I'm like, okay, you have to get some survival tactics. You see, you need water, you need food, you need something by the couch, because your bucket to relieve yourself,
yeah, you'll just
you are
sit
not
there.
Moving. Yeah. So just understand that.
Donuts, water, and something to sit on and shit at the same time. That and that scene, by the way, in season 3 with Brother Muzon is a great scene because you shot him in a great moment where you call 911 for him after you shot him. It's just, and they're discussing their weapons. Just these two guys who are probably going to shoot each other discussing Jesus. Their weapons. So
yeah,
great,
you would love
man.
That.
Fantastic.
It's,
yeah.
It's such a, everyone I've turned on to the show fucking goes out of their mind for the show. They're like, why was this not higher publicized? Because the critics loved it, but never nominated. I've mentioned that many times,
yeah.
Which is sickening. House and all these fucking dumb shows that are nominated. House. Oh, the doctor does
once
it again.
He's got to find out why a child is bleeding from the ass on an all new House. All right, we get it. He handles weird cases.
You know?
So you were saying you grew up in Brooklyn?
Yeah, Flatbush.
So now, all right, I lived in Brooklyn for a while. I kind of steered clear of Flatbush. But
smart man.
Now
smart
did,
man.
Did you get out of there? Obviously, you know, you're an actor. You're doing very well. It seems like you would have gotten out of there kind of young. Or
I just can't seem to get out the hood for some
reason. No?
I don't even know if I really want to get out the hood. I kind of like the hood. I'm in Newark right now where they got bodies dropping all around.
Hey, the garden spot of the Garden State.
Yeah, man. I got the 4 young girls got murdered around the corner from me. So
I was just watching a show called Jack last night, which is on
Jack.
Yeah. And it's this squad that goes around Jersey. And they were in Newark during the episodes I was watching. Mm-hmm. And they just put in plate numbers of cars and just by luck, they find stolen cars all the time. People driving around, and that's all they do all night.
Shout
Newark
out to
seems
Newark.
To be
up the hook right now.
Yeah. It's like they're just stealing cars like crazy over there.
Cars, lives.
Yeah,
money,
it's just
whatever.
Insane. Now, what's the attraction to being in that atmosphere when you know you're obviously doing very well?
I like you. I like you. We gonna hang out, but I mean, you know what I'm saying? It's affordable for number one, and my family's there. You know, I still go back to my hood in Brooklyn. I still have family out there, and you know, we chill. I go visit my aunts and, you know, my god kids.
Yeah?
Yeah, my god kids. He said, yeah.
Yeah. No. You got friends over there, though, that are kind of still in my life or anything? Or
what kind of, yeah, like, you mean alive?
Yeah, no,
the
still,
life, like the
yeah,
old,
yeah,
the
like
old,
kind of,
oh, hell yeah.
Fucking
I mean,
around a little
absolutely.
Bit too much. And
yeah, you know, we've all been there, but yeah. I got people that just, that know Mike.
Yeah.
Before the Omar thing.
Yeah, that's kind of, I can understand that a little bit. People kind of take, because people kind of take us for what we're worth here on the show. And it's a little odd when you meet people and it's like, no, I don't act like that all the time. I'm not like that all the time.
I'm not drunk off my face all the time.
Well, no, that I am. But,
yeah.
No.
You mean sober. I don't act like that all the time.
Yeah, there you go.
There was it's so hard. Like I know as an artist, you want to move on and you want to do like all these other projects and you want to be But it's like, I just want to fucking, I'm like a 5-year old. I just want to fucking say Omar things. All I want to do is say, what up, bird? That's all I want to say. Probably one of the best, for anyone that hasn't seen it, he's falsely testifying against a guy to get him thrown away for a murder. Because the guy is a piece of shit. I mean, Bird's a piece of shit. But he wants Bird, and he and Bird both know he's lying through his teeth. And they say, do you see the defendant in court? And he looks at the guy who he's lying about. And he goes, yo, what up, Bird? And he just wants to fucking cut your throat. It's such a great moment. What up, Bird?
That was one of my favorites, by the way. The court scene was definitely one of my favorite scenes. That's from season 2. But like in the beginning, I remember people started coming to me like, yo, Omar.
Is that season 2 or season 1?
That's season 2. The courtroom scene was season 2.
With Bird?
Yeah, with Bird. When we're in the courtroom and he's testifying.
I think that's season 1.
Look at you arguing with the guy that was in it.
He's in it.
Shut up, Jimmy.
I love this
fanboy.
No, no, he's in it. But I've watched it more.
I believe him, too.
He doesn't watch it and go, Omar. He just goes, oh, it's me again. Let me fast forward. But, you know, wasn't that, that was for the oh, you know what, he probably is right. That was for the
right.
Civilian murder.
Yeah,
when
the working man got murdered, right. The courtroom scene didn't happen until season 2.
Oh.
Yeah.
All right.
Jimmy.
I'll stand corrected. Since the guy who did it, I really should have my fucking teeth kicked
don't
in.
Don't feel bad. I made so much money last year on people betting whether that was Michael that killed Bodie.
Oh, really?
I made so much money off of that side betting.
You know, you could win a lot of money off of people asking what season of Lucky Louie it was.
I love.
It got a laugh from
oh,
the
you
people.
Know Lucky Louie? Joe,
I was man. I got starstruck again. He came to the premiere of.
Jesus, not you. Him. Lucky
yeah, I
Louie.
I love Lucky Louie, bro.
Yeah, I know his name is Louie.
I didn't miss an episode.
Did you recognize me when I came in from Lucky Louie?
You.
Oh my God! Oh shit!
Holy shit! I'm laughing, but this is pissing me off to no end.
Yo, you the neighbor, the crazy fucking neighbor. I love you. You and the fucking
Janitor
walk around naked all the time.
Oh yeah, Rick Shapiro.
God,
someone check
you. You got me cursing, man.
Dude, no, that you don't know how much this pisses me off because I hate when he really likes an actor and they come in and know the motherfucker. I hate it.
Lucky Louie. Dude, I watch that shit every step. Every time, every
I made the joke
hard.
To goof on him, and it backfired.
I'm thinner now than
Shut
I
up.
Was then. That's probably why he didn't recognize me. A man walks in shape; it's kind of hard
face,
to see.
That face, you know,
it's a shape, all right.
Face, exactly.
Ask Sensei when you was coming down the hallway. I said, I know that face.
Yes,
I swear to my God, I was telling Sensei that.
Damn.
In the hallway.
Yep.
Damn it.
That makes me very happy.
I'm sure it does. It makes me miserable.
It made me mad. It took
it
off the
air.
No, I'm not going to cry. But another guy from The Wire who was actually a fan of Lucky Louie was fucking Method Man.
I think me and Meth had some conversations about Lucky Louie.
Yeah.
We talked about that. We talked about your show and said we had lines from your show we bring it on and we laughed. There was something. You know, I smoked a lot of side pot. So it was a fry. But you had a few one-liners on that show that we started running them. Man, I had skits from Lucky Louie. Did you see what that was happening? He was like this and that.
Oh, that makes me so fucking happy.
How'd you like his acting? Was his acting good?
Man, that whole show was incredible, man. That was real life comedy. Like
very Honeymooners-ish.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
like, you know, the X-rated version of Honeymooners.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, the R-rated.
And Louie never sweetened any of the laughs because every comedy sweetens them. They all balance the laughs and they put in these little laugh tracks to even it out.
Yeah.
And, he never won. People would complain, some of the critics, that the laughs are too loud because these little fucking pussies, they're used to these sitcom laughs that get evened out. Louis didn't do that.
No, you had real people in there laughing.
Yeah.
That's what you needed. That's what you needed in The Wire, a little laugh track. Imagine that horrible, some horrible shit going down and just an awful laugh track.
Like the old MASH laugh where there's that one guy trailing off.
They actually throw a laugh track in MASH?
Oh boy, did they?
Yeah, it was awful. I don't know why they did
it.
They did an episode.
Klinger probably had all the one-liners.
Oh, I think they did one episode without a laugh track and people complained.
Well, as time went on, they removed it because it just seemed
the storyline. It was like it just didn't go. The storyline was getting darker.
It didn't.
Yeah,
make sense
yeah, that's
to have
true.
A
it kind
track.
Of were, it was more the anti-war thing going
yeah.
on. And I there's a laugh track in Hogan's Heroes. You know, when you got a POW at Nazi POW camp. Oh yeah. Oh, that's great. Look, here comes General Bull Carter. Oh, he's gonna come in and.
More prisoners are coming in. This is fantastic. Swastikas on the walls.
Remember that shit? I used to love that show.
I'd love to know who pitched that, though. Because you know they're pitching it to Hollywood producers, probably Jewish guys.
Probably.
And they walk up, and it's like, I got a great idea. It's a comedy based in a Nazi POW camp. Go.
Green light. Yeah. Green light. It's going to be huge.
Well, they
it's
probably said, we won't do that. It'll make money.
Okay.
Okay. Never forget.
Plus the Nazis.
That it's on Thursday nights at 9.
A rumor that he got you.
Oh yeah, the head yeah. Hogan.
Yeah.
Well, he was into some really kinky fucking group sex stuff and videotaping it in the early days of video.
Yeah.
He was videotaping stuff, and then there was a rumor that he had sex with some guy's wife.
Yep.
And that he bashed his head in. He got his head bashed in with a tripod.
Yeah,
with a fucking camera tripod. Wham! They just caved his head. Bob Crane. Yeah.
With his fucking... I hate to keep doing penis
dirty
references.
Dirty boy.
But apparently Bob Crane was packing like 10.
You had a nice one?
Yeah. And yeah, he gave it to a lot of different girls and some husband probably. His son came in to promote something a few years ago. Remember that?
They should release those films because he videotaped himself just fucking Bob Crane fucking. Just call it that. Bob Crane fucking.
Yeah.
Fucking Bob Crane.
Yeah, fucking Bob Crane.
Bob fucking Crane. You get all three domain names, so no one can fucking steal it.
And when he comes, you just hear Hogan.
Hogan. Yeah, his helmet looked like fucking Schultz's.
Hendrix, there's a fucking videotape of Hendrix.
Yeah.
A fucking that, which I almost went in a porn store and bought. I think Red Light District, who gets all that
How
stuff.
Long has that been out, though?
I don't know.
It's just odd that things have come out. Like, it's very hard to keep anything secret anymore, especially things, films, pictures, things that have been buried in secrecy for years.
Coming out now
with YouTube and stuff like that.
Yeah.
It's out there, you know? See, I guess what I'm saying is watch what you do on film, people.
How about just do nothing on film?
You know what? The only thing I've ever done is set up a video camera with a TV and no videotape in there. So you can kind of monitor what you're doing.
Yeah, no videotape.
So there's no videotape. You're just kind of looking. And then you just feel silly.
Yeah.
You just look and go, what is that? Oh, my God. No, that's me from the back.
You feel silly and safe.
Yeah, silly because there's no record of it.
Yeah, exactly.
The first time I ever got a video camera, I actually recorded myself jerking off because I wanted to see what I looked like.
Why would you do that?
And then I taped over a couple of my sets with it.
Why wouldn't you just burn the tape? And then, see, that's how it happens.
There was 1 second of me jerking off.
Of course.
I had a bunch of people over my house watching this tape, and then there's just 1 second of, and the angle was from in between my legs, so you saw my gray nuts and just me like this.
Oh shit!
For 1 second, and it was just like, "What the fuck was that?"
It doesn't butt up against each other.
And then Wild Kingdom showed interest.
You showed him the coffee table, huh?
Yeah, it was just, I have a gray sack, like a pig.
I call it the coffee table. The coffee table. There was a episode I watched this show on Showtime called Weeds. So one time, the brother and the councilman was talking, and they were discussing what is the part between the asshole and the nuts. What do you call that, right? So they were like, yeah. So the maid walks in. They go, what do you call the space between the asshole and the nuts? She goes to the coffee table because that's where they were sitting in between.
Oh, shit.
Oh, that's
a funny fucking line.
Wow. Coffee table, so you were showing your coffee table.
That is fucking beautiful. What a great improv line that is.
Man, it's classic.
And we were talking, I mean, there's, again, for Wire fans, we were talking, Michael, I was talking off air. You know, as two men from HBO will do, just discuss things off air.
Of course.
I was on HBO too, stupid, at the same time.
You were.
Doing what?
No, but you aren't talking about it with us. Did you ever see Torgasm? Dane Cook's Torgasm?
I was getting ready to say, you let the dude from Dane Cook's Torgasm. I swear
Holy
to God.
Holy shit.
I swear to God.
No hugs.
Now, Bobby, he didn't want to hug you. He didn't want to hug you. He did it
okay,
to be
America,
polite.
It's official. We HBO family, we jerk each other off, man. We watch each other's work,
Anthony,
bro.
Go take a break. Come
Look,
on.
I gave a bow during Jimmy's performance on HBO.
Then come on
I
in.
Stood up and went like this.
That is true. I shot a special, and him and Opie, who's not here today because he's sick, came to, and I acknowledged him in the audience, and Anthony stood up.
Yeah, right.
And did
I'm on the radio. The fuck do I know? I'm not on
fun,
HBO.
That's a real family vibe that we support the other show. Like, you know, it's the first time we're meeting, but I've watched both you guys' shows. Like, really.
That's
I watched
hysterical.
Yours more than yours, but I
pointing to Norton and then to Kelly.
Yes.
Second.
Make sure you clear
Can
that
I just
up.
Say something? I did too.
Hey, Michael, I want to talk about a Spike Lee movie you're in.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, how is that working with Spike? Because some people say he's a breeze to work with. Others, not so much.
Well, I'm on the breezy side.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, you know I didn't have to audition. He wrote the character in, and he had me, you know, flew me in on his private lair, and you know, and had me land on top of the hotel. Now I'm just
yeah, right. But,
he did write me in, and he did make me the offer for the character. He was
was that because of the Wire? So
yeah,
you're on
the wire, you know, and you know, it's just I had a great time working with him. I think he caught me. I was with him like 3 weeks out there in Tuscany. I think he caught me, Michael, maybe like none. He caught me Omar.
Oh
time.
Shit!
And whenever he saw me, wherever I was at, whether it be the restaurant or when I first got to work, when the set, anything, whenever he first saw me for that day, Omar coming, Omar coming, Omar coming, and it was like Spike killing me. He's phenomenal. He's real quick. He knows direct. He knows what he wants. And like I like to call him the method director, because this dude is just really he's a genius with just creating scenarios and these scenarios and putting you in it to live in it even when you're not on the set. We went through boot camp. You know, he put us up in this really high mountain where like your ears would pop in the Tuscany, and you know, you had like wild stallions running around. It was, you know, the boot camp was like really rough conditions weather-wise. But it was nowhere near as extreme as what those actual soldiers went through when it was going down. But we got to get a taste of that. We shot in the actual space where the massacre happened, which is the Sergico River in Tuscany. So it's like a lot of history. You could feel the eeriness.
Wait, was that a true story? I didn't know if it was a true story.
Yeah, true story.
Okay, it was.
Well, I mean, not about the miracle with the whole head thing.
Yeah, no, but I mean,
I'm
like
talking about the war. I learned this just as I go. So if I sound smart, you know, it's by coincidence. But apparently, in World War II, when Hitler was trying to take over the world, having his pinky in the brain moment, he was next to go on to Italy in this part of this region called Tuscany, and this was the first time that I believe Patton, General Patton, he said, "Yeah, get them niggas some guns. They want to fight. And he gave blacks first time guns, but it was like minimal. You know, we had
a bunch of muskets.
Yeah, the bare minimals. And we went out there, and in this river, we got massacred. And
wow.
And it was because they got massacred, and there was he was calling in and saying, "This is where we are. Bomb the position." And the white commander didn't believe that they had actually advanced across the river.
Exactly.
And was bombing behind them like a fucking dope and not hitting the enemy.
Yeah.
So that's why they're stuck here. Oof. And they wind up in this little Italian village. And this one guy, he taps into every fear a man has. Who is the guy, Bishop? A guy with a real slick dude who just wanted to fuck the Italian women. And the one guy's fallen in love with the Italian girl. And and then Bishop just keeps going over. He's pretty much talking about how black Americans have huge dicks. You know, he's trying to hint that to the little dumb guinea broad. And there's a scene where...
you know your great-great-great-great-grandpa?
Oh, I love this guy. Yeah. And walking so angry, he licks his lips and he mouths... You can't get the gun fast enough.
That was hysterical.
But it was a fucking... Spike Lee's actually very funny, too. He's a kind of fucking... He's got great comic timing when he's in his own films and he does funny shit, man. I love Spike.
Man, he's a genius, you know.
Was he in the movie at all?
No, not in this one.
I don't think he's put his stuff in one of his...
Kind of takes out of a period piece,
since,
if you...
Since X. He hasn't been in one of his projects, mm-hmm. in one of his joints since X.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He should be. He's always funny. It's like a Hitchcock thing. Maybe he got compared to Hitchcock too much. He didn't like it because he would always... I'm really talking quickly. But he would always... I drank a lot of caffeine today.
Wow, you are going. Yeah. You're on... What are you, boy or girl?
That's
what is that?
That's a girl.
That's a girl?
Girl's up, boy is down.
I've made that mistake, as we all are well aware. But we were talking, you know what, look, some of them
Friday,
sometimes, especially...
It's Fry High Day, what the hell?
Some of them are so passable, you know, a lot of the Asians are too, but when you get to the Spanish, a lot of times, forget about it. Hi, Poppy.
You got to touch the Adam's apple.
Yeah. That's right, if they have one, you hand them the money.
Yeah, you do.
For you guys, we do a studio audience here, and they're not mic'd today, which is, hi guys, are you enjoying yourselves?
Thank God.
Yeah.
Shit, I almost went on TRL.
Yeah, it's kind of cool. Total retards line.
And it's funny, I didn't realize that Michael, I don't realize when you're on a series, you watch it the same sometimes as the fans. But there was a scene where a guy named Bodie, who's up at the end of season four, he became a huge character.
You sure? Season four?
Yeah, it was
yes. Well, the fact is, I'm quite sure that Michael was right about season two, that scene. And the
fact
that I debated him.
Yes.
Not only a show he was in, but a scene he did. Like, he wouldn't remember when he did it.
Of course.
Man, but I love it, though. That's what we're here to do, you know what I mean?
But he said he was very sad when this guy got killed. Like, I was surprised that
You can get ahead. It's a sad. Like, mm-hmm. I didn't say sad. I said I fucking cried. You know, and I did. Man, when first of all, big ups to JD Williams. He's a phenomenal actor. I've been watching his work since he was a baby on Oz, and it's just to watch him. He's on Broadway right now. He's getting ready to do Broadway, the Roundabout Theater. I'm just so proud of him, man, just to be in his presence. But when they killed Bodie, I'm sitting there in Newark, house full of dudes, and you know, and we're sitting there, and like, I didn't, you know, I knew it was coming, but I didn't, man, just to see it. And it's just, so I had to turn my head. I was like, damn,
oh, shit.
Caught me. You know that unexpected crowd. You just didn't, you know, your eyes get real.
It's where you're sitting and everything's fine. And then you go,
oh, yeah, you know.
It's like, what did I just do?
You have to blink quickly.
Quick blink.
Lest my friends think I'm a faggot.
Man, I couldn't even look at the screen no more, man. And then what got me when Poot came and said, he grabbed him by the arm and said, Bodie, you don't got to do this.
Yeah.
Man, and then he just pulled him off and said, ma'am, this is my corner, and I'm a rock out with my cock out. And it broke my heart. You know what I mean? I guess, because, you know, you work on the show, you know, you go to the office. It's like 4 years I've been working with this dude, and friendships kind of happen. Yeah. You know, we're down there, and he formed these bonds, and I like the character. I like the dude that plays the character, and, you know, to see that happen, it kind of like, you know, well, he's not going to be at the office next week.
Right, so you guys are seeing not only a character kill, but a guy who you like who's not going to be there for the next season.
Yeah, that's the reality of it. Same thing when they took Idris, when they took Stringer Bell. That was a hard one. That was a real hard day at the office.
And you're the one who did it. Hard day at the office. You fucking popped like 16 bullets into him. The two of you shot him together. That was a great scene, too.
That wasn't that intense.
That dumbbell trying to get involved in real estate when deep down he's just a murderer. And they fucking gave him a good killing. Oh, boy, did they. But you were happy to see him go. After the way he fucking killed...
D'Angelo.
Oh, boy. Yeah. He fucking had D'Angelo killed. He was fucking his woman. Oh, he was a terrible dude.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah. He was a big, handsome dude, too. Like, if you're in jail, that's the last guy you want to check up on your broad.
No, yeah. Oh, bro.
6'5" and
well
built.
When I tell you, the female gender came at me with such hatred.
Really?
I didn't answer my phone for a while. It was, I'm talking like my mother caught me and cussed me out. Like, Ma, I'm your son. You killed fucking Stringer, baby. Nah, but it was hard for a while.
That's pretty funny, though, when your mother gives you shit for stuff that you don't like. That.
Real talk, my mother does not even watch The Wire.
Oh, okay.
She doesn't support it. Doesn't
support my mother tells me all the time, she goes, I couldn't listen to you today, your show. I don't listen. I'm like, all right, well, you're kind of out of the demo. You're like 70. But, you know, maybe once in a while to see if I'm still employed.
You know, they once in a while to check in on me, you know.
I think she still thinks, like, this is just me and my friends hanging out. She's waiting for me to get a real job kind of a thing, you know?
You know something? I think our mothers must be sisters.
Yeah, it's one of those things.
One of those things, right?
Trade. A trade. You'll have it your whole life.
Get an education.
Something to fall back on.
I'm like, Mom, there is no plan B for me.
Like, Mom, I'm sitting in my house. Got some broads over here. I'm drinking champagne.
You want to come over?
Don't worry. But yeah, come over. We'll smoke a joint.
You know what I mean?
She'll be there. She's crazy, too.
Yeah, Mom.
Your mother?
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's a party animal.
I'm going to jump at this conversation, but my mom's right. I should have been a hairdresser.
Why, Bob? Mm,
you're doing great in your career.
Really?
Yes.
You're in a movie with Ricky Gervais.
Yes. If you the new Ghost Town movie, Bob.
You're in that?
Well,
no.
Let's phrase that carefully. Yeah. In the same way a tree or a car is in it, Bob is kind of behind. He plays one of the bodies behind Ricky Gervais the whole time. Yeah, Bob,
dude, congratulations, bro. There's no such thing as small roles, only small actors. Shakespeare.
Well, it's not quite a small actor, but
yeah,
you're getting smaller. I'll give you that. I hate the fact that Bobby's losing weight. This guy, oh, you should have seen him. He was a disgusting fat motherfucker.
Yeah, really.
That was just obese.
Wait a minute, he fell into
the category of obese. He'd come in, and when he left, we'd just be like, how fucking fat is Bobby getting?
What? You never told me this shit.
Yeah.
You made a couple fat jokes. They were cute. Obese.
I never made a fat joke about you. None of them were jokes.
Yeah. Yes. They were sad observations.
But now he's losing a lot of weight.
Yeah.
And tons. And he looks good, and it's ruining our whole fucking thing with him. You're fucking dieting yourself off the show is what you're doing. You're not going to be able to come on. We'll be like, oh, Bobby Kelly's here. What do we talk about?
Nothing.
At least you could breathe.
Yeah. It's not.
Well, you know what? You know what inspired he is? Because when he was on Lucky Louie, you were a heavy boy.
Yeah, I put a lot of weight on. Craft Services.
Tell me about it.
It's phenomenal. You just eat fattening food.
When I saw he started losing weight, but he had his HBO special, and one of the photos they come in and take photos. He was laughing at one point, and his neck was back, and he had five layers of skin. But they were five different colors. Like it went from purple to black.
Looked like some exotic bird.
It looked like a pelican.
I was heavier, but I wasn't as bad as he. The photo that this was.
No, it was bad. It looked like you ever have roast beef and it goes bad in a rainbow.
It sounded like it was that bad.
It was the color of bad roast beef.
Wait, can we get that picture? It was a HBO half hour shot in 2005 or 6.
Looks like someone should be throwing a fish on his nose.
All right, so it's not flattering. It's not a good photo.
Now.
Thank you. I look all right now. I look better now.
But
that's how you know I was bad. I really was a chubby fucking Lucky Louie. I see some of that footage. I'm like, oh, you fucking pig.
That was some of the shit that was classic. The hilarious.
Yeah.
You watch Californication.
No.
Oh, no. Weeds. You said Weeds. Okay.
Yeah, Weeds.
What was
some of the early stuff you did? Like, what was like one of the first things you did as an actor?
The very first thing I did as an actor was a film. With Tupac Shakur and Mickey Rourke called Bullet.
That's not a bad first film.
I remember that movie.
That was
Mickey's a crazy guy too, right?
I spent like one day around Mickey because our scenes were different. But Pac, I got to hang around him a lot more. But when I did meet Mickey, he seemed a little quiet. He's laid back, reserved, just easygoing.
Do you look back on that though and go like, oh, what was I thinking? Like, because we've done this to ourselves a lot. We take our early works and we bring it into the show. Either play it on video or play it on audio and just cringe like, what the fuck was I thinking back then?
As far as my acting career, there is nothing that I would cringe at. Now, I had another profession before I started acting, which was dancing.
Okay. There could be a cringe moment there.
Yeah, there's somewhere on God's green earth, there was footage of me in hammer pants and a belly shirt.
Hammer pants and a belly shirt? Yeah. Oh, wait.
What's a belly shirt?
It's a little half shirt, right?
Yeah,
it's every shirt you wear.
Girls call them tit tops, but I can't go here, so it was a belly shirt. I got some cringe moments as a dancer.
Wow.
I mean, if my mentor Tupac Shakur could be on a stage with Digital Underground with some Speedos on humping a fucking blow up doll, I could be in some hammer pants and a belly shirt.
Wait, was he in that video?
That was live footage. If you watched the Thug Angel, there was some footage when his first gig was the roadie. He got a roadie. He was a roadie for the Digital Underground.
Oh wow!
And then he bumped up to like background dancer, like it's got to be part of the stage show. And they would get in these like really colorful Speedos type thing underwear and hump on blow up dolls on the stage. So when I saw that, I was like, you know what? We all got a past, and we all come from somewhere. Damn it!
Yeah, yeah. You're back to her.
You ain't born as sexy as you is. You gotta get morphed into that.
Work on it.
Yeah.
Damn, that's rough. That's a rough one.
Hey.
Footage out there somewhere, though.
Man, listen, I wouldn't trade a thing.
Anyway,
I'm at today.
When did you find out? Because I was shocked.
That's not it.
When. If you Google Jim Norton and then just look up images, I think you'll find it's one of the first images. It's a fucking disgrace. when did you find out that they were going to, spoiler alert, wait, you...
Derek, is that
nope. No, go that's down, me go from down, Lucky Louie.
Go down.
No, it's none of those.
Go down.
It's his book cover.
None of those.
You got a book, dude?
Go to the next.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, he wrote a book.
Yeah, it's all about my experience with prostitutes and stuff like that.
Oh, man.
It's true. I'll give you a copy. It's,
I get a copy. I should have been in some of those.
It's called Happy Endings.
Oh, do you love the hookers?
Yeah.
A little weed, some hookers.
I'd love to pull a train with him. I'll fucking pay for the chick. You take whatever end you want.
I fucking would love that.
You're a pisser. Most people are just like, hey, you doing anything for lunch? When you first meet somebody, hey, a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
You're like, hey, pull a train with a hooker.
Yeah,
hey,
let's grab a chick and fucking let's high five over her back.
Yeah, hey. Put her on the rotisserie.
Pass the blunt. You know what I mean? Is that him? Is that it right there? The picture?
Oh, you kind of look a little mopey in that one. What's that black and white one from your old days?
In that last picture, the one with the blue hoodie on, you look like dude from Extras.
Oh, go back a second. That was 2003, and that was just kind of an image shot.
Yeah. That was you having a Dove moment. Dude.
That was the before picture.
That's the Dove commercial, you having a Dove moment.
A woman thought, this photographer wanted to photograph me, so I took these photos, because she thought I would actually be handsome with holding flowers, which was bizarre. I know I'm not a good photograph subject, so I fucking just put
on... Man, beauty's in the eye of the beholder.
Thank you.
Well,
there's me in 50, you know, you pass through them.
Where Curtis at?
Go back one.
You in 50?
Go back two. Yeah, I have a great shot with 50, actually. Go back two, please. Top left. I know this is radio. Top left.
Oh, don't worry about it.
Yeah.
You know something? He has this thing with no matter who you are or what you are, when you get in a picture with 50, you point at the camera. Like, what is that?
Yeah.
Like, it's like you feel like you have to do that.
That's
like,
a camera.
Yeah. Yes.
Everybody is like, it's something when you know, it's like, I never saw people do that before he started doing it, like, you know, pointing the camera. Like, that's a camera.
That's a camera.
And that's a photographer behind the camera.
You just do it. I don't know why my hand went up.
It's a 50 thing, I'm telling you.
He's been shot. At least he has a reason to be kind of gangsterish. I put my hand up like, yeah, two peas in a pod. Yeah, I flew to Cancun with him. We were on doing an MTV stuff totally separate. It was coincidental that we were sitting together.
All right.
And I
glad you cleared that up.
Well, I didn't want him to think that I was trying to imply that, you know, yes, you know, Fitty and I do gigs. And I tried talking to him, and I just ran out of steam after like a minute and a half. Aww. It was fucking humiliating. 4 hours of silence.
I found it. Yeah. You look like a middle-aged woman. Who's
oh, God damn. Yeah, okay.
You should be just selling stuff on eBay in Albany, New York.
That's not the most flattering.
Look at that neck. Look at those lips.
All right, the smile is not good. It's a jovial moment. I really am.
But you were in character. You were, you know, it wasn't like you were posing for the camera.
You should be pulling your head off saying, 2 weeks. 2 weeks. And have Arnold under.
Yeah, that's not a...
Get ready for a surprise.
Listen, just remember, I got a belly shirt on somewhere.
And hammer pants.
And hammer pants. It don't get no worse than that.
But I had hammer pants on, too, in my first headshot, because I started comedy in 1990.
Oh, should have a hammer over your head.
I believe
it. And it would bounce right off.
A fucking... The claw end fucking buried in my coffee table. There's a photo of me with hammer pants. I used to wear those workout pants. I didn't wear the belly shirt, but I thought that was like a really cool hip look. From 1991.
Yeah, remember that? It was.
It was. You know something?
It was hammer time.
For a time, it was for like 10 minutes.
I actually bought a pair.
There's a window.
At Pier 1 Imports. I bought. They weren't real hammer pants.
They were sails for a ship.
I really wish I was fat again right now.
I know.
Because you're on fire today.
I can't.
These are just great.
Just annoys me.
Dude, you can't do that, but I got liquid in my mouth.
Fucking hilarious. Because as soon as you say that, we're all thinking of, all right, fabric big. Fabric big.
Smart asses.
Wow, that was a fucking
goddamn smart ass.
That was a
fucking gem.
You say, you know, working with Tupac, is it a surprise you or upset you or anything that nothing's been really solved in his murder?
It's a little upsetting, not too much surprising.
Yeah.
It is a little upsetting.
I mean, no one's talked.
Disappointing, right?
No one's talked. I mean, everybody has their theories and, maybe more than theories as to what happened. Do you have, and I'm not even saying to say what it is, but do you have your theories of what happened?
Yeah, I do. Tupac Shakur was murdered.
All right. You know, I'm going to go along with you on that one.
There you go. I know.
All
that
right.
For, I
now
know
the
that
big one.
Sure.
Who do you think did it?
I got the answer for that one, too.
Yeah.
I am absolutely positively. I mean, I know for a fact it was not me.
All right.
All right, it was, that'll never be solved, like, or Biggie. Nah, it's mob hits. I mean, guys that are just gangsters, no one's gonna fucking rat anybody else out.
I mean,
out.
Within a week of Tupac, of them killing him, like, you know, like a string of murders happened.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
The dude that he was fighting with in the Vegas club got murdered. His brother in Jersey got murdered. it's just, you know.
It's just such an odd thing, a crossover between entertainment and the mob, because it's pretty much it's mafia tactics. It's, you know, it's fucking old Cosa Nostra stuff mixed in with popular music.
Yeah,
so a lot of people
tactics, but I don't know if it was the mob per se.
Well, no, not the mob.
No,
I'm
not
talking
the
Italian, you know,
mafia, but that just the thing of real life and entertainment that really. Oh,
it's like fucking Sinatra
car,
shooting Dean Martin.
Shot that car, they knew what they was doing. You know, with the whole Cinemass thing. You know, mm-hmm. You know, it was. It wasn't, they were just popping off with the hand twist like this.
Right,
you know,
right,
the hand twisted. They were very good.
Turn
shooters.
Your sights up, gentlemen. Yeah. Please, could you just turn your sights up? I think you'd save a lot of kids that way. Just
what do you mean by turn your sights up?
Oh, turn the sights up.
Yeah, you, no,
that
no,
sideways shit.
Is this for the
It
for
might
the
look cool
really
in the movies,
it,
but
it really doesn't.
It looks so old school
it
now.
It looks real old
it's
school.
So 80s.
Yeah, it is 80s.
Buck.
Yeah.
Who
it's
just
like,
did
wait,
that?
You're going to shoot yourself in the foot.
You know what I mean?
The King of New York, there was a fuck. I think when Fishburne got shot, I think the cop who shot was Wesley Snipes. Wait, no. David Caruso shot. I think Caruso at one point points
did
his
that?
Gun as a cop and
but
fucking
you did.
Points
you did.
Sideways.
It was an 80s thing, 80s, 90s.
I did out at the range one day just to see what it's like, and you can't hit shit.
And you mess around, and you know, we thin guys, man. You mess around and get that kickback from them guns, man. You hurt your wrist.
Yeah, that's not the way you're supposed to do it.
That is not the way it's supposed to go down.
We have, just so you know, too, Dane Cook is calling in 1 minute. You'll hang, right?
Oh, okay.
Hang?
Absolutely.
Okay,
yeah,
cool.
Hang out. You got to play my new record.
Yeah, we definitely will.
Yeah, that's right. What do you got going on?
Man, you know, I just decided to put Omar on wax. One day during first season, I got a phone call from the late, great Jam Master Jay, and he was commending me on the phone, and I almost crashed because I was driving. But he commended me on the phone that he loved the work, and he had this concept of putting Omar on wax. And, you know, I've been working on that for the past 5-6 years. You know, I'm not a rapper, so I had to first learn how to rap. I'm like, sure, I could do it. How the fuck do you rap? So, you know, I had to go find that out. And I've been working on it for the past 4 or 5 years. Unfortunately, the day that I was bringing the first thing for his ears, since he had spoken to me over the phone, that's the day he got murdered.
Wow.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, so he never got to hear this in the physical, but I know he's somewhere above shining on my little effort. But so this track here, I'm not a rapper. This is not Michael Kenneth Williams. I do not want to be a rapper. This is Omar on wax. Omar don't even rap. He's throwing over the beat. And I got a real powerful track opposite Mary J. Blige. It's the we call it the Mary O remix. And that's what we're working with right now. Omar Cummins, the name of the record, the name of the album, actually.
We'll hang out and we'll play that after we get Dane.
We will definitely play that.
Dane on the phone. What? We got like a minute or something and Dane will be on?
Yeah, supposedly. Mm-hmm. I think we were supposed to have him around.
What's the matter, Bobby? You don't know where he is right now?
Why don't you call him?
Huh?
Yeah, why don't you call him in your red highlighted first guy on your fucking iPhone list?
Second guy.
I love it. It's
Dane,
second guy.
We need you, Dane.
Norton's first.
Oh, he is?
Yes.
Yeah, I put Norton first, and then I put you second.
No, you didn't.
You're right. You're not even in my phone. I deleted you off of Xbox.
I got to pee real quick. I'll be right back.
All right, Jimmy.
Got a tinkle.
Do we have time to take a quick break then, if we do that, and then wait for Dane?
Let's do one.
All right. We'll take a quick break. Jimmy, go wee-wee.
All right.
And when we come back, we'll talk to Dane, and Michael's still hanging out.
Yeah.
Please. What are you fucking raising your hand? Take a piss. What am I?
Can
your
I
dad?
Wee-wee?
Out of here. Just don't touch
balls?
Each other's weenies. Bathroom break, boss. Shaking it off, boss.
He's actually, we got him right now.
Well, tell him to fucking wait. The guys are taking a piss. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back.
Okay.
Every knee must bend, every head must bow, every tongue must confess. Thou art the greatest of all time.
Ella, Ella, A.
Yeah, we suck.
Opie and Anthony, y'all.
When you walk through the garden, gotta watch your back. Well, I beg your pardon.
Andrew, we're back on the radio.
Yeah, it's all right.
Yeah.
Opie and Anthony show.
These people bothering Michael for a picture. Why would you do that to a celebrity guest?
Oh, I'm kidding, of course. Jimmy's the worst.
I'm the worst.
And I'm officially a family member of the Opie and Anthony show. I have my t-shirt. I'm official.
Look at that, yeah. Got the t-shirt. Been taking pictures with the audience. We've brought them in.
Yes.
Yeah, like we usually do on Friday and then regret it.
Yeah.
Look at that. Patty's here, of course.
He calls you audience while you're here, but I wouldn't tell you the things he was calling you.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah, well, they know. They hear it on the phones. They hear it in live appearances. They know what they are.
Usually it's just the bleacher scum, but today you're the audience. Yeah. Kidding,
hi, Patty. By the way, she's a 50, how old are you now?
53.
53-year-old virgin. She's never,
sub, Patty.
Yeah, that's stalker Patty. Hey, she's never been, but never been with a man. And, well, you know, I'd love to talk to you about it again. Actually, I wouldn't.
We have,
I lead a good, honest, clean life.
Oh, shut up. We got Dane on the phone.
Jesus Christ.
Let's go to Dane Cook, who's been waiting patiently on the phone. Dane?
Hey, man.
Dane, congrats for being in Bob Kelly's new movie. look at him. He's got a good laugh there.
No, I was in Ghost Town.
Ooh.
Because I'm not in yours.
Yeah,
what? We had to cut Bobby out. Bobby's on the, Bobby will be a featured DVD extra.
Oh, God. What happened?
He just didn't bring it.
All right. At least you're honest.
Yeah, that's not what you told me.
He didn't bring it.
Bobby just didn't bring the high caliber ha-ha that he usually does. He was lackluster on that day.
You know what? Can I just say something? I think he's being really truthful.
Yeah. I think he is.
There's not one fucking...
And hurtful.
Yeah.
And Bobby will try...
The scene was hilarious, but, you know, that's the whole thing with these damn movies. You know, you do it and your favorite stuff always ends up, you know...
But that was telling right there. Bobby's scene was hilarious. It's like one scene.
Yeah.
Hey, look, it's one scene more than I had on a cutting room floor.
I know. You chatty Kathy on any fucking talk show you're on.
Don't feel bad because I went around bragging to everybody. I think I told the world that I was in the new Incredible Hulk movie, and I ended up on the editing room floor.
I made it to
the deleted scenes. I found out, so I guess Ed Norton felt about me the way Dave feels about me. I was lackluster that day.
You didn't bring it.
I didn't bring it.
Well, Dane, Jesus Christ, you pumping out a few movies?
Yes, indeed.
Really, yeah. Funny ones, actually.
When does Satan have to come back and take the soul, though? Is this it? The last one?
This is the last one. And then, part of the Satan deal is I would be relegated to, off cable.
do you have two movies out?
No.
All right. It's just one. Okay. I just see him on all the time.
Yeah.
You're on my television constantly.
No, Jesus. Sorry.
Get off.
Don't be sorry. You bring laughter to my life.
That's Michael K. Williams, and the fact that he's like a fan of yours, it's kind of hurting my heart because he likes you more than he likes me.
Well, he's good looking, man.
He really is a handsome dude.
Damn.
He'll have the chin neck thing going. Yeah,
multicolored pelican neck.
It doesn't look like you get at the bottom of the ocean.
It's a little light on it.
Something hovering around the Titanic.
So what is this movie now that you're in now, this week?
Yeah, I mean, the thing about this, you know, I've done a few movies up till now that I think, you know, there's been some nice highlight moments. You know, I've made some comedies that I think have highlight moments, but this is the first one that my company actually produced. I get to get my stink in there. My comedy urine. Is all over this movie, which
urine.
Is great. You know,
so you marked it.
A movie that really kind of took the essence of my comedy and put it in there in a fashion that was much more presentable. Instead of just being leading man, hey, I'm in the middle of the movie and Andy Dick's over here being a nutbag.
Yeah,
it was like let me get in there and actually do my funny my way.
So this is one that's kind of like, this is one that you're happy with as far as like from beginning to end. You're like, this is the way I wanted to come out.
Yeah, like with my other movies, you know, I watch it and there's like, you know, scenes where I like, you know, would leave the theater and, you know, not come back. but this one, you know, I watched it with the crowd the other night in the premiere, and I was just, you know, stoked because I knew, okay, great, when this scene comes around, let's see if that worked. Let's see if that gets the big yucks. And
it's got to be a lot of pressure.
And I get to play like a villain. You know, this is like the bad. This is like playing Darth Vader, but he uses his powers for good because Tank Turner is a hired gun. This is the guy you bring in. Let's say you cheat on your girl or you do some dastardly deed. You can hire me to come in, date your ex, get to know her, drive her absolutely bad ass crazy.
You can say shit.
Be this maniacal douchebag to her so that she comes back to you.
Oh, okay. That's kind of interesting.
It's a twist. Dan, can I ask you a question?
All that, and I got that's kind of interesting.
No, no, I because it had to sink in for a minute. It was sinking in like I was getting a grasp on the whole thing going, you know, I was thinking it through. Like, with
No, I'm going to use that in the marketing campaign. I see the commercial now. Opie and Anthony say
kind of interesting.
Hey, thanks for blowing up my spot.
Yeah, I'm a dick. Okay, you're right.
I'm trying to get persnickety here. But
it sucks. So kind of interesting. I'm a tool.
Michael wants to ask you a question.
Do you the films that you're in, you write them? You write those stories? Or do you write, like, I know you write your comedy, do you write your lines, or have you written a script? Like, how much in the writing are you involved with?
Yeah, this is the first film that, and this guy, Jordan Cahan, who I've known for a bit, I wrote it with him. I mean, he wrote it, and then I came in, and, you know, we adjusted it for my comedy. Other movies I did, I came in after it was like, okay, it's greenlit, and it's going, and there wasn't much maneuvering, but with this, it was like all the way down to location scouts and, you know, getting it filmed back in Boston and casting. So this is the most authentic, you know, film version of what I do in my stand-up.
Dan, Bob Kelly.
you look great, by the way.
Thanks, man.
Doesn't he?
The Asian tapeworm worked.
That's a line from the... Big Fat Girls. What's her name? Anyway, that was a scene, Asian tapeworm thing. She was trying to lose weight. Come on, the actress. Fat actress.
I'm not going to help you. Oh, the chick from Kirstie Alley?
Kirstie Alley. That was a scene. She was trying to lose weight. They anyway.
Okay. So,
Jim. Nice one.
Bobby, yeah, ask me a question. Is Bobby asking me a question?
Yes, I believe he is.
Bob's got his interview voice going on. Well, Dane.
What do you got, Bobby?
Yeah, well, first of all, big fan. And second of all, thank you for all the money you've given me. And third of all,
he's listening to this ass lapping.
Third of all, how funny really is Alec Baldwin in this movie? Because he's everything he does, I love when he does comedy. But I mean, how funny is he in this movie?
I got to tell you, he's kind of interesting. dude, Alec Baldwin. Here's the thing about Alec Baldwin. You know how funny he is, just like 30 Rock, and you know how intense he is from, you know, Glenn Ross. But you can tell the guy's like he's a titan. I mean, he should be carrying a friggin' lightning bolt in his hand. He's unbelievably just his presence is. I say about Alec, it's like if there was a bull in a china shop and Alec Baldwin walked in, the bull would sit there and patiently wait for Alec to leave.
Yeah.
He's just he's kind of scary. There was a day on set, you know, I always have what I call like, my A-lister ball bust moment. And I do it with Costner, and I did it, you know, every movie I've done, there's that
Kevin?
About 2 weeks in where I'm like, okay, I feel comfortable enough with this person, I'm going to bust their balls. And with Alec, we were shooting a scene one day, and he was really pissed off because he couldn't get this little monologue down the way he wanted to, and it just wasn't coming out. And so I'm standing there with him and the director and writer, and he's really going on, and he's just like, I don't feel like this works. This is something that we need to rethink. Wow. And he's going on and on. I finally just said, listen, Alec, sincerely, this is what I'd like you to try. Forget the monologue. Just say Beetlejuice 3 times in a row. His eyes become razors. And he stares at me for about 3 seconds, and then he just went, Beetlejuice.
Yeah, there is something about. I was just watching The Departed last night again, and he's great in that one too.
Yeah, no, the guy's Alec Baldwin, a tremendous actor, and I couldn't believe we got him. And then he just came with the funny, and he'd rewritten scenes, and he was improvising. You know, again, the DVD stuff is like always a lot more fun, even because you get to see two people just kind of going toe-to-toe. So it's a funny flick, and he's great in it.
Dane's publicist is saying he's got 1 minute left. I guess they got a phone thing.
Yeah, we're doing a phone tour. before.
Oh, those are so much fun.
Dane, this movie, this isn't like a romantic comedy because some of the trailers are like, it looks like a Kate Hudson's out to meet the guy of her dreams or some shit. But this is a pretty edgy flick, right?
Yeah, you know the movie company. They have to try to, you know, pull in as many asses in seats.
They're trying to get more vaginas in the seats, I think, with that. The movie poster looked a little kind of chick flicky.
Yeah, no, I had a little fun, you know, roasting the poster there about a month back because I couldn't stand for it. I was like, okay, first of all, if you look at the poster, I or no man on earth who has any balls at all would crane their neck that far from anyone.
Yeah.
What's the poster?
Can we see the poster? Over my shoulder that far like an owl at a woman. Shoot me in the chest.
Dude, we've talked about this before where when I used to go into Blockbuster and stuff, I would get douche chills just looking at some of the video covers.
Yep.
There was somewhere the actor would be looking at the female lead and giving that, oh, now you, and she's got her arms crossed looking over her shoulder like, well, you too.
Yeah, don't you think of it, mister.
And I'd look and go, there's no way I'm ever going to see this movie just based on that. See, and you're looking over each other's shoulders. Yeah. Look at your friend. Holy fucking Photoshop.
Yeah. Those aren't even my lips.
No.
Yeah, those are like Angelica Houston's lips from like 82.
And the guy's standing there kind of watching this whole thing go down like, oh, let's hope.
Yeah, and you got the, like the scruffy beard thing going. Wow. Yeah, this.
Honestly, I never even posed for that picture, and it just, it's so weird. So I had to, you know, it's the comic side of us that you just want to, you can't let those things go. So I just told Lionsgate, listen, I'm going to bash the poster because it stinks.
Yeah, you ought to just go around and every time you see one, draw a big cock into Kate Hudson's mouth.
Yes.
Like just, well, I don't know. You take a Sharpie and just do it. Nothing personal. Just it would make the poster funny. Nothing makes a poster funnier than a real archaic drawing of a cock in someone's mouth. We all laugh at it.
We certainly do, endlessly.
Your publicist has given a shit, Dane.
Right. The movie comes out today, right?
Movie opens today, yeah.
All right, well, it's called My Best Friend's Girl. It was obviously with Dane and Kate Hudson. Right. And
Kelly's coattail, Dane Cook.
Do you see me at easy?
What? You are.
You're Opie's.
What?
Can you see me at all in the movie? Like, even like a cheek?
That sounds sad.
Big, fat shoulder.
Oh, that's sad.
Wow.
All right, man. Well, take care, Dane. And, good luck, brother.
Bobby, I should tell you right now, Bobby, your scenes are still there, but we actually overlapped Orny Adams' voice.
A lot of people don't know who Orny is. He was like the comedian that got painted as a dick who was behaving like a dick in the Seinfeld documentary.
Yeah, mm-hmm. This is the most press that he'll ever get is us talking about him right now.
Yeah.
Me and Dane saw him on Runyon Canyon, and he didn't say hi to Dane.
Why?
And he said hi to me.
Yeah.
Why?
Because he's a fucking dick. He goes, oh, I'll say hi to you. And Dane was like,
I'll stop and say hi to you.
And then he shook my hand, and then he goes to shake Dane's hand, and Dane was like, what? He goes, what, you won't shake my hand? He goes, you just told me you didn't want to fucking shake my hand, you psychopath. Oh, he's nuts.
He's an odd guy.
That's why Dane. I like him, though.
Dane Cook.
On an up note.
My Best Friend's Girl.
This weekend, number one movie.
Tonight.
Yeah, that's
tonight. Tonight. Right? Yes, tonight.
Theater hopping later, checking people out and seeing if people. And also, I have a tradition that I always, on opening night, sneak into a theater and I masturbate next to a stranger to my own movie.
That was you?
Holy I nudge them as I'm wearing my hoodie and I peek out so that they tell their friends, I'm telling you, man, it was him. He was jerking off right behind me.
I thought my popcorn was salty.
I do the same thing in your movies. Every time you come on screen, I'll just go, I know him.
All right, Dane, thanks a lot, man.
Right,
good luck with the movie. Yeah, it's kind of interesting.
All right, you
guys
enjoy it.
All right, man, later.
See you, bro.
I didn't mean kind of interesting in a bad way. I was processing that whole scenario in my head. Yeah. And I'm like, that's like interesting, you know? All right. Like you always kind of think of a scenario that you could put yourself in and if that would work and stuff. So I'm like, oh, it's kind of interesting.
That's good, Anthony.
I did.
Oh, Jesus. Bob Kelly takes a whole banana in his mouth in one. Dude.
A fucking rookie cannot do that. No, you're a pro.
He can actually really watch this.
He can take a stalk of bananas in his mouth.
Ah, you gagging fucking lightweight. Oh, and I love to see you in Slap Happy.
Exactly. Oh. Too fucking many Asian dicks, Bob.
Fucking bukkake, your eyes all red. Red, dry, jismed eyes. That's what I want to see. Big fucking red eyes on you. Oh, man. Well, you know, we always got to acknowledge the audience, especially on a Friday. There's so many people that come in on a Friday. Where are you guys on, like, Monday through Thursday? Working or something?
We're from Canada. We came all the way down from Nova
fucking Georgia. Canadians. Ugh.
Someone has good taste in reading material.
Yes. Yeah, so
what do you got? Oh, Jimmy's book.
What a good man.
Thank you, Jimmy.
How many loonies did that cost you? Or toonies? Well, they're stupid money.
6 months ago, more it was than cheaper now, than in the States, but now the dollar's gone.
Yeah, dollar's kind of coming back, isn't it?
Oh, is it really?
You had your day in the sun for a couple of months there.
Now,
hey, our dollar's, our dollar's more than yours, eh?
Well, I'm so glad we could throw your quarters away again.
That's it. I hope a moose eats your book.
Fucking stupid tin quarters.
Yeah, what is that? What do you got? A loony, a toonie, and a five? You don't even have like a dollar bill?
No, it's gone.
Yeah, what the fuck? You got to carry change in your pocket.
It's terrible.
That's stupid. Canadians jangling all over the place.
Yeah, they probably cut down
on
burglars.
The penny, though. The penny is going away.
The what?
The penny. We're getting rid of the penny.
Good.
What'd you say, Jim?
Good for you.
I said that fucking in Canada, there's probably, I'll let me explain. Oh, he thought my joke bombed. No.
No. Nobody heard it. Let me say it.
I was saying that because...
Let me see if I can get this out without laughing.
Because it's all change. I was saying there's probably not a lot of burglaries because you'd hear the guy jingling, "We heard you, Jim."
Canadian burglars linger longer.
Canadian burglars linger longer.
Yeah, well. Wow, so Canada. What part of Canada, sir?
Halifax, Nova Scotia.
Wow, Halifax! Holy shit!
I once ate
someone from Halifax.
I once ate a chick's ass from Moose Jaw.
That's the opposite end of the country, Bob.
Oh, sorry.
Jesus Christ.
Literally, right?
Did you really? What do you do in Halifax?
What do I do?
Yeah, what do you do?
I'm in lumber billing supplies wholesale distribution.
Of course, has something to
Goodfellow.
Do.
Of course, there's something to do with fucking lumber. Lumber.
Something wood or fucking antlers. Something to do with. So you're, yeah.
So how far, let me ask you, how far, not to completely ignore you, when did you find out? Sorry, I'm addressing
my question. I want to hear a song.
Please.
We're going to hear a song.
Yes.
But I have a selfish question I want to ask.
All right, go ahead.
When did you, and I hate to spoil it for people, but if you haven't seen it, you haven't seen it. When did you find out that your character was going to get popped?
In The Wire?
Yeah.
I always knew when I got hired, they told me Omar was going to die. I just didn't know when, but when it actually was coming, I got the script about a week before, about a couple of days, maybe a little less than a week.
Just scratch out the part where you get killed and rewrite something. Hey, I had an idea.
Omar gets elected congressman. No one will believe that.
One thing I never do is scratch out anything that David Simon writes on paper.
Very diplomatic.
Yeah, just leave it alone.
That was my worst TV moment. My worst TV moment ever. I couldn't. I was fucking.
Mine was Torgasm. I love you, Bobby. I do.
It was a good one. It just hit me right out of the blue.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
It's all right.
It was fucking. I just sat there with my mouth open. Fucking
again.
Anthony's
sorry,
on fire.
He really is. I gotta shut up. I'm sorry.
But we're giving him. I'm giving him the biggest setups. And so I said, point to an asshole. Fucking. It really was. I mean, I fucking sat there and I couldn't fucking believe it had just happened. I couldn't believe it had just happened the way it happened. It was so unexpected and so non-climactic in the sense that it didn't get to where you wanted it to go, and that's what he said he was going to do.
That's being so into a show and into a character when something like that happens and actually affects you like that.
Yeah, but he said on purpose he was going to hurt people.
Yeah, that too, and that was the shot heard around the world. I don't think I've heard that much controversy over a TV character being shot since JR.
Yeah. Why though? Because because what I don't get is
because
he's a bastard.
Was,
he's a, like a bad guy.
But he's, that's what the whole premise of the show was. Not all the bad guys are bad, not all the good guys are good.
Mm-hmm.
But I think what hit people so hard was because it was so unclimactic and so unexpected, and it was so was not what everybody wanted to
that's
see.
That's the way shit happens.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Exactly. Yeah, you know, it's when you least expect it is when it happens. So And that's very it's very symbolic of where the average state of mind where the youth is in Baltimore, in the hoods at least, you know, life is real cheap out there, and that's what's going on. But me personally, as an actor, just, you know, the Michael K. Williams moment, I was kind of glad that, you know, the whole Marlo and Omar gun battle in the middle of the street thing didn't happen. I think we had shown enough of, you know, the whole black on black thing. And then, two, I didn't really believe that Omar would have. I just didn't want them to like desecrate his body or like to make him torture or to make him suffer in any kind of way.
Mm-hmm.
So I was kind of glad that, you know, a little kid came and just, you know, put him at rest, as opposed to him having his long dragged out, you know, painful thing with, you know, Marlo, Chris, and Snoop. You know, I didn't want that.
It was leading towards this giant, epic thing of these two Titan characters where it would almost become like, oh, that's what TV does. And when they kill him in a deli, it's fucking,
you know, I haven't seen it.
It doesn't matter. Most of it happened. It was, you know, you're like, what the fuck? It's not going to happen. It just, and it's done. And the cops are over him. And when they're not looking at him like Omar, like the fans are, the one cop goes, Omar got killed. He goes, Omar, really? And then he goes on with the investigation.
Yeah, that's it.
And his rival doesn't even freak out. He goes, yeah, I know about that. I thought you were going to come tell me that earlier or something. It's
it's
a matter of fact.
And as a fan, you're like, what the fuck are you doing?
That's how it's supposed to be.
Very matter of fact.
And I'll tell you something. Wendell Pierce, who plays Bunk, he had a huge problem with that. He wanted this whole, like, this moment to go through his, and they were like, absolutely not. It's a matter of fact.
That's too TV, right?
It's just another day. And like, you know, this year they did the whole on-demand thing, right? When you could get it the Monday. Mm-hmm. So the phone calls started like that Sunday night, like at 1 o'clock in the morning, that Sunday night going into Monday morning, the phone call started. And it went on through the whole week because people just get it on demand. It wasn't until that Sunday when it actually aired, that I had to like stop answering my phone for a little bit, because it just was because, you know, people were coming at me with all the emotion, just like the morning emotion, and I was pretty good with it. You know, man, it's all good. This is a TV show, man. It's all good. You know, bigger things ahead. But there was one phone call that pierced my armor, and it was from Wendell Pierce, who plays Bunk. He was somewhere, I think, in New Mexico filming. I was in Arizona working, and I was actually on my way back to the airport. Car full of dudes, you know, we smoking and, you know, going to the airport, getting my little mind ready to take this flight back to New York. And he calls me in the car, and he the conversation that we had and where he was at, you know, as a fan of Omar, as a friend of mine, and as one of my mentors who he knows he helped me to mold this character and to handle this type of phenomenon. For him to hear him on the phone where he was at mentally and hear the things that he said to me, it took me there. And I was like, yo, Wendell, I cannot go here right now. I'm in a car full of dudes and you taking me there. But he definitely
pushed your buttons.
He pushed my button. He had me welling up in the car there.
Well, you guys had an amazing scene together where he's been with a cop, Bunk's a cop. And he's just kind of criticizing the way you handle being in the neighborhood. Now there's no sense of community anymore. And all you do is you sit and listen to the whole thing. And then at the end of it, you stare straight ahead and he hawks out the greatest wad of spit. I don't know why it works so well. It's just this fucking disgusted. So that was such a great scene between you. That's probably my favorite Bunk scene.
I've never had a bad scene with Wendell, man. We, from day one, from when we were first found that we went to high school together.
Oh, yeah, yeah. A few years apart.
Season one,
yeah.
Yes.
Sure that wasn't season five? God almighty. Shut my fat face. Wait, weren't you Ted? You weren't Omar.
Yeah. Ted.
I got some trivia for you.
Oh.
Who when and where and who said for the first time a man's got to have a code?
I'll say it was Bunk at that first meeting.
Yes, absolutely.
Wow, Jimmy Norton. Yeah. God damn.
And then when was the second time you heard it?
Shit.
Shemale, your apartment.
No. The Shemale said, I'm a man. And then something with code. I didn't have enough time to think about that one.
I'm a man, now bend over.
Yeah, exactly. I'm a man, now give me my money. Fuck. Cut you with a box cutter soaked in garlic. Gets right into the bloodstream that way.
We've all heard the tranny stories.
Oh, yeah. Right in the bloodstream, the garlic. And it won't heal. You bleed out.
Yeah, it's very bad. Very bad news.
Oh, shit.
You grind your knife in garlic, and then you stick and you turn. Oh, problems.
Yeah.
But when was the second time you heard man got to have
it
a code?
It was, a man's got to have a code. I'm going to guess it was, I don't remember.
Master Poe? Man's got to have a code, gentlemen.
Code. I think it was an Omar callback. I just don't remember when it was.
You got it. It was legit when he got arrested and he used that the get out of free jail card he got from season two, and he was, because they remember they framed him for the murder in the candy store, Marlo and them, and Bunk would say that ain't Omar style, and he Bunk came to see and he was talking, and Bunk was like, man, even if you didn't kill this one, you kill so many other, that's why shouldn't I let you rot. He said, because you could sit me in here, but then the man who really killed that lady is still out there, and he gives him back the card. Man got to have a code.
Oh, shit. Fuck, I would not have gotten that one. The first one I did.
You didn't.
I'm amazed.
You're right, I didn't.
I'm amazed you got the first one.
Well, you know, when you're a fan, you fucking remember these things.
No, I got to hear a little of your rap song here.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Absolutely.
What
is the gist of this?
Now, like I said, this all started. This is just Omar on wax. Omar spitting. So the name of the album is Omar's Coming, right? But this track here, I was in Chicago working on my campaign with Obama and in Gary, Indiana. Big up to my Chicago.
Oh, where can I volunteer for that?
I got you. If you're serious, I got you.
No, he's not.
No, I'm not.
He's a gun nut.
He's a gun nut that has millions of dollars.
Yes, he wants Wayne LaPierre, and if he's not around, fucking no.
I want my taxes cut and bullets. Right. That's pretty much what I want in life.
I think that's pretty much the American...
yeah, that's...
Taxes cut to my bullets.
Believe me, McCain's... I have no love for McCain or the broad that he's running with. But
I got some love for the
She has a juicy little rump.
Isn't she though?
Yeah. You know she fucks too. She's got five kids.
Man,
so you know she likes a dick.
Yeah, you look at her, she get pregnant.
Four and a half.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah, the last one.
Something a little bad.
The last one, the husband jerked off on her thighs and her feet happened to be up. Fucking leaked in.
Jesus, what's wrong with
what?
You?
Oh, damn.
It's just terrible, dude.
Well, that's, you know, she's got one of those right to life stances, so it's one of those, you know. Yeah. Sometimes abortion ain't a bad thing.
Yeah,
that's all I'm saying.
Would you, if you had a fucking baby with?
If I found out,
if he had a scientist, he'd abort it.
I don't give a shit. I don't want any kids. Yes. Fuck that noise.
It's a future president. Yeah, well, it's got a hanger in it. Fucking beat it.
There it is. Your first exam is going to be from Doc Martin, right in the fucking belly, you bitch. I don't need any of that shit.
God. Oh, I just can't wait till the end of this when I suggest to Michael that he and I like trade numbers or something. And he's like, oh, my agent's email.
Nah, negative.
Just negative.
Nah, I don't like the way you just set that up on air. So you
I know,
sure.
So now it can be done. You are a fucking chick. You're a fucking chick.
Hold on, I know that, but don't deconstruct it until later, stupid.
Yeah,
I'm like,
hold
on, let me interview my friend like he's not my friend. So Dane, tell us about this motion picture.
Ooh. That had
that,
a hurt,
no, that
Bobby.
Was totally different.
It wasn't.
You
no.
wanted his phone number. Yes, I did. I was kidding. You really want his number.
You weren't kidding.
Hey,
you,
Mike.
You weren't
what's
kidding.
Up, Jim.
You said
he'll pay for hookers for you and stuff.
My like, kind of
you
friend.
Need him? I know. Hey, we'll get.
My kind of friend.
Yeah.
You were like, dang, this is a, this is kind of like a, you know, an edgy comic, which was a fine to ask, but it was the way you asked. You talked to him like you were interviewing.
I know what I did. It was different.
No, it wasn't.
Yeah, it was.
Jimmy will be smoking weed.
Oh, no, I won't.
No.
I don't go
oh,
there.
Oh, no.
I quit many years ago.
That's your problem, my friend.
One demerit.
One demerit.
One demerit. I can live with that.
Why you smoke weed, Tony?
I get a contact high.
What does that mean? Off the whores.
Apparently Canadians only smoke pot.
The whores you have at your house, all 18 of them
Canadians
smoking.
Smoke a lot of pot, don't they,
what,
sir?
Some of the best pot almost come legal. From Canada.
Almost legal.
Some of the best
yeah,
pot
it's almost
in the world
legal.
Comes from Canada.
Yeah, that's where all the like good
what
shit
the
is apparently.
Good shit is out there, bro.
I hear everyone in Halifax is stoned all the time.
What? Pretty much.
Yeah.
All the money they should be
spending. It's a great state of mind to be in.
That's what I hear.
So relaxed over there.
Yeah.
No stress. The place is clean. Canada, relaxed.
They know they got us down south protecting their ass.
That is true. They create nothing. They don't even check terrorists. They're like, no. You have something strapped to you. Go right through to Buffalo. Fuckers.
Yeah, all right, getting back to my record.
Yes.
Okay, this is called Omar.
It's called the Mario Remix. What happened was I was in Chi-Town and this track came to me. I heard it. It's actually the original is with She and Big Boy from Outkast, right? It's the same kind of same vibe song, but I heard it and so we remixed it and it's called the Mario Remix.
All right, we'll give it a listen, man.
Man, the people got questions, now we need some answers. We ain't never been pampered and we tired of getting hammered. If you tired, then you follow me right up to democracy. Then you probably see why I be who I be. See our rights getting left and our souls getting sold. And the highest bid is the kid and this joke's getting old. So tell me you don't feel the same damn way. Day after day, like you in long run delay. You got something to accomplish, but it's stuck in the nonsense. The forecast is plain ass, you gotta respect the rain check. Nah, folks, America spilled a yoke a while ago. Breakfast was supposed to be local, said it's just logo. You know so-and-so with the resources, the big bosses, their flaws, electric college courses. But you missed the lecture thinking it was for suburbia. And now you feel the pain, America says she never heard you.
Trying to tell us to stay strong,
you
but every day we're losing jobs.
You did.
College Park got the Beverly Hills.
Yeah.
Something's gonna have to give.
No, that's right.
Across the world they live in fear.
Oh,
but it's the same thing over here. If you can hear me on Capitol Hill.
I hear you, Mary.
Something's gonna have to give.
Now crime is way up courtesy of me and my Dillinger. Cause they never let large percentage. They fudged them figures in the schools. They empty courtesy of political juggling. Administrators by fact cause they BS the budget. Now we all out here struggling and some of us stumbling. Man, you gotta do quite a bit cause the inner city be crumbling. The advocates is frauds, man, we need more brawls. Ladies protect their kids, it's their peers, they leave in tears. No longer is it cool to call the white persecuting black. Look who they turn crook, look where they put Martha Stewart at. When tsunami hit, America came quick. But when New Orleans got drowned, FEMA couldn't be found. How profound, they clown when the poet risks the backbone of this country seems to always slip a diss. If Asia got help 3,000 miles away, why couldn't Ray Navy get it the next damn day, huh?
A single mother and a struggle and it's no fun. But you don't really understand until you are one. A child is sick and he's losing his endurance. She wanna fix him but she ain't got no insurance. And we don't even wanna talk about the man's plight. I don't parole with the promise that he'll do right. But a felon has no chance for a new start. So it's back to doing hand to hand on his own blind.
Black and white, we're all the same.
Yeah. Help me deal with the drama. Is that maybe in November I'll be cheering for Obama?
They're trying to tell us to stay strong.
Yeah.
But every day we're losing jobs.
Every day.
College Park got the Beverly Hills.
Ooh.
Something's gonna have to give.
Give it up.
Give
it
up. They live in fear. But it's the same thing over here.
Over here.
If you
yeah.
can hear me on Capitol Hill.
Listen to me now.
Something's gonna have to give.
Give it up, y'all.
You fools best believe this lady of ours. For corporate approval, get paid by the hours. Your elected officials, they just waiting to dish you. And your ropes is old news, like rundown shoes. Miss you would say she close to being MIA. Cause when it come time to protect, she guilty of neglect. The medicine now costs an arm and a leg. And when the SNS run out, the seniors gon' have to beg. Now I don't know about y'all, but Omar real. I ain't never gon' let my mama face that ordeal. We begging other countries keep the all running freely. And in our own backyard, got the starving and the needy. Police, they seedy, fire at will. They got the crackers beefing, even they getting killed. Your teachers was prudent, but now they sex the students. You better protect your child, cause America's gone wild.
But it's not that way. They've been selling us a dream, telling us we're on the same team. Now we all gotta deal with the lies.
They're trying to tell us to stay.
Beverly Hills. Something's gonna have to give. Across the world, they live in fear. But it's the same thing over here.
Over here, yeah.
You can hear me on Capitol Hill.
I know you hear me.
Something's gonna have to give. Yeah.
Bum.
Damn.
That's great.
Man, that sucked.
That was kind of interesting.
My goodness.
It's kind of interesting. Our audience is gone. They were frightened and left the building.
Really good, man.
Thank you.
It was very Tupac. It was very...
man, you're the second person that said that. Thank you.
Yeah, it was very Tupac, like, you know, some of the stuff. And it's commercial, too, because you weren't up there fucking suck, you know, fuck my dick.
Well, Omar don't curse anyway. This is strictly a concept record. It's all Omar. There'll be no bunch of profanity. They ain't gonna be a bunch of fancy car driving, rim spinning, bottle popping, club going, fancy clothes wearing. None of that. None of the trappings of what you usually hear is what's gonna be this record.
If this becomes a hit and you have to make a video, will you put Jimmy in?
You already made the video.
Absolutely. No,
I'd love to be in the
video.
Yeah, I mean,
we got Ike Stapleton. He shot his new director. He shot the video. It's gonna be on I'm going a different route with this. I'm putting this right in the street. You know what I mean? So the video gonna be on YouTube, I guess, about another. And he's heavy at work in the editing room right now, but I guess another week or so should be starting to circulate on the YouTube.
Yeah.
So you want this out a little bit before the election? I mean, it's political.
It's not even really about the election. You know, I'm involved with the campaign, but I'm by far no politician, and I don't have any political agenda, if that's what you mean. It just, I was 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm in Chicago doing my thing out there with the campaign. I was high. I heard the trash. And, you know, it was 3 o'clock in the morning by myself on my homegirl's deck, and this track came to me. I heard it, the version with her and Big Boy, and I was like, I just wanted to lend my voice to it, you know, as Omar, and just went with it.
It's great.
I was, you could play Whitey in it.
I'll Jimmy. Play...
You can be Whitey.
That's too easy. I want to play something that challenges me a little more.
Do you know how to dance? Can you dance a little bit? Can you be one of the dancers? Show us.
Yeah.
I thought there'd be too much dancing in my project.
It wouldn't be. That's
no dance.
Not unless he's doing a Yosemite Sam dance. You know, when
shooting the guns.
I like to do the Watusi in a shithead.
Okay, what is the Watusi?
I don't know. I just like the word.
Good.
It's an old dance, I think.
It's an awful dance.
I can relate to that that song, though, as I'm sitting by my pool.
At poolside.
I'm too white.
Nah.
Oh, believe me. I'm one of those. I listen to the words and go like, just don't take my goddamn tax money. Jesus Christ.
Hey, that's really what we all want. If you know what I'm saying, that's what everybody wants.
Cut government spending. That's what I say.
No, just don't cut it. Just give it to me.
All right, even better.
Give it to me. Pass them over this way.
You know what it costs to heat my pool?
a 30 cents a month.
Jimmy doesn't like my jacuzzi. He says it's cold.
That fucking coldest jacuzzi on
it
the East Coast.
It is not. I finally
in.
Figured it out.
Would you have to heat up tea water?
Boil the kettle.
Well, Jimmy decided he'd heat it up by pissing in it, you fucking animal.
I fucking dropped there 4 gallons of whiz in his fucking jacuzzi. Yo, but it was self-preservation.
Is this truth or this a joke? They got this new chemical they put in public pools now that when you piss, the water turns like
the scare kids.
No, the scare kid. That's not true.
No,
right?
That's not true. Let me say that for 30 years. I was a kid.
That was just some lady.
That would be a great invention, though.
Dude,
yeah.
I don't
put it in there. Someone
that.
Pisses. They're just stuck in a bunch of blue.
Everyone
like, chastising them.
Yeah, because then some innocent person would swim through it and it blew on their face. No, that's been a rumor since I was a kid that they have something they put in the pool. There's a little thing they put in where
you
urinate.
You urinate, yeah.
And this
Jimmy
way,
come back from a pool party with a blue tongue.
Yeah. Yes, I'm a bit of a...
It's actually happened to me, though. It's actually happened to me. I've seen this yellow stuff, yellow goldish stuff. Just kind
it's a yellow dye.
It's a yellow dye
kind
of all around me.
Yeah,
when someone pisses, it turns yellow.
What's better than the naughtiness of holding a conversation while your dick is floating straight up because it's water and tinkle is just flowing out of it?
Oh,
there's
God.
No better feeling
that
than
is,
pissing
that,
in a pool.
That is a good one.
I swear to God, in water, period, that feels good. But talking about the pool, is that when you know, saying the dick is, you know, the water has it floating up and you just let it go? That shit feels
you're
good.
Just like,
what happens if you
gets
dick?
All warm in your
warm and, you know,
in your shorts.
In your shorts.
Well, what do you mean your dick floats up?
Bobby. Oh, poor Bobby.
Bob's just stands out like Bob naked in the pool looks like the fucking cover of the Nirvana album.
Yeah. And Michael's is like a U-boat periscope.
they call him Nessie. Itchy.
Poor Bobby.
He said, what do you mean it stands?
It floats up.
Does your penis look bad in water?
Yeah.
Really, who's doesn't? I mean,
if the water's cold, you're fucked. You're fucked, man. That's
big,
why, you know.
Boys going inside, right inside the stomach.
Whenever, because sometimes girls, you know, they want to have sex in a pool or in a lake or a jacuzzi, and it's too cold.
Your jacuzzi's cold.
And I know, apparently my jacuzzi's cold. I want to fucking scald you. I'm going to fill it with boiling water and push you in and pull out a little Tom Turkey when it's done.
I've never actually gotten into a jacuzzi where my fucking balls were tighter when I got out of it than when I got into it.
Come on.
Usually you got to steep your scrotum in there very slowly. Not his.
It works fine now. Trust me. But girls, sometimes you know you want to have sex in a pool, and it's probably the worst fucking place to have sex. First, if it's cold, you're gonna have an issue.
Yeah.
The second you pull your fucking shit down, and then just there's no lube.
Yeah,
in a pool, it gives that. It's like sliding on a gym floor.
It's
with your
really,
knee.
Yeah. People think because it's wet, it's automatic lubrication.
No!
That's not really the fact.
Plus, if you don't skim the pool, you're jamming fucking mosquitoes in it. A leaf comes out of her pussy.
Well, she'd rather that than sand. I know that much.
The fucking guy that comes to clean your pool goes in the skimmer and comes out looking like Spunkmeyer from Aliens 2. Spunkmeyer, what's that on your hand? Remember? Fuck.
There you go. I like that one. Yeah.
I was hoping for a good, rare Aliens reference.
You're all right.
I could hope.
I liked it. It was funny, but it was just like a really fucking obscure one. It's still good.
Yeah. Yeah, went with the fucking cum in the skimmer. There's so much there.
Yeah, there is.
There's so much there right now.
A fucking load sticks to you like rubber cement. Though.
I thought it was
the fucking worst. No.
What happens when you stick cum in water? It's like, that's the last thing you want to do is wash it off. And no. Then that turns the crazy cum. Like, then you're like, mommy, my head is stuck together.
A friend of mine on your legs and
pulling little wads off of your fucking leg hair.
It's like you're being attacked by your own semen.
A friend of mine used to. I jerk off in the shower. He used to call it making eggs. You go off making eggs in the shower.
I never jerked off in the shower because of that same reason. It's just, I'm like, I got a shower after the shower.
I just redid my shower. And if you know, tile or a bathtub, the load just goes right down the drain.
Yeah.
But slate. I got black slate for my floor.
Ooh.
Oh, and it just turns immediately to egg and then it sticks like the spot, like
yeah,
spawns
it landed.
Tape.
Yeah.
I'm sitting there. Every time I jerk off the shower, I have to like jerk off into the drain.
Into the drain,
so
yeah,
down. Because if not, I'm in there plucking stuff off. One by one, little nuggets of fucking my baby.
It'd be a fucking plumber that's got to undo the trap on your fucking.
Oh, that happened to me once.
Oh, great!
I used to jerk off into the toilet and just flush it, but I do my ears too, and I throw them.
You jerk off in your ear? What?
Wait a minute.
What are you doing?
I clean my
ears. What makes you feel sexy when you're going to the toilet?
Yeah,
how do you jerk off?
I'm so not in the mood when
I don't feel sexy. I feel fucking
horny. But I mean, lonely,
desperate and alone. Desperate, yeah, exactly.
Lonely, desperate, and alone. Hi, Patty.
I do that in your house or other people's house. Have you ever jerked with someone else's bathroom? Or that's
fun, yes. Yes. I think I've jerked off in this bathroom.
Oh, God. It smells like a fucking monkey cage in there.
In the work bathroom. That doesn't count. Everybody jerked off.
Work bathroom.
Oh,
yeah,
man,
yeah.
I did when I worked at a funeral home. Just get a good look at those dead tits.
Have you ever mounted any of them?
Of course I have.
This is the term when you screw dead people. What is that?
Hot.
Necrophilia.
Necrophilia, right?
Necrophilia, that's what it is.
Yeah, some people are into that. There are some guys that won't go the distance with fucking a dead chick, but they like girls to bathe in ice water or my jacuzzi. And they get out and they're just completely cold
and frigid.
And they just want them to lay on the bed and fuck them that way.
Really?
So they feel really cold, yeah.
That's so bizarre.
Yeah, like it's a necrophilia fetish. Yeah, and then after that, you get the shovel. You fucking go down the cemetery. Find something hot. Hope I got a good one.
I mean, if you want to fuck someone who's not moving, just date a Jewish girl. Oh, no, sorry. All Jews?
Oh, jeez.
Sorry, Hollywood.
I actually, no, I think you're right about that. Not I did is Israeli, and it was
they're different. Israelis and American Jewish girls are completely different. Well, Israeli chicks are fucking insane, hot. Crazy.
Dude,
they're in the army
the
at
worst,
8 years old.
The worst fucking, sex ever. You ever been
really?
Fucking a girl and you want to punch her in the face? She sucks so
the
bad.
Question is, have you ever not? Of course you do.
Oh, explode in me like Tel Aviv bus. Yeah, the sexy talk can't be all that hot.
Sneak into my asshole like the Mossad in the 72 Olympics.
AJ,
oh, Christ, man.
Oh, yeah. Shit.
Yeah, you had an Israeli chick, though?
And
she was bad?
She would get on top and her move...
That was it? Like she's posting on an
this,
English saddle?
And then she'd look at me and she'd be like, are you having fun?
Bob's not moving his hips, like, just so you people know. He's saying that she would straddle him and her hips would stay steady, but she would just kind of move her torso and allow that weight to push down on his dick.
Just kind of like, like she's riding an English saddle.
She's shrugging.
Yeah. I actually, one time I was like, stop, stop. She's like, what's wrong? I'm like, this just sucks. This sucks.
Take her, why don't you just throw her off of you and roll her over, do whatever.
Exactly.
Like, you're in there, too.
Yeah, but...
You're fucking choreographing half of the fucking shit.
Did she
don't like what's going on at that moment? Fix it.
Did she have a fucking... Was her pussy bald, or did she have, like, a Gaza strip?
She had a big...
You know she didn't have a Hitler mustache.
No.
We know that.
Golda Meir mustache. the blood was
actually,
hairy.
It was two little curls that hung off her vagina.
Oh! Oh! Yeah, Jimmy hears that all the time. Pay us.
Oh, oh my God, a Jewish hooker pun. Nice.
Jesus Christ. All right. Well, we're wrapping up real soon. Yeah, like 5 minutes. Any interesting stories in the crowd? Sir?
Yes, if you're not going to see Dane's movie tonight, I was hoping you might come down and see my friend John Valby, Dr. Dirty.
You like John?
Yes, and yes, and I made that movie here with you guys a bunch of years ago.
Yeah,
what's it
years
called?
Ago.
What's it called?
It's
I
called
Have Slacks
Gary...
and Camel Toe?
No.
Holy shit.
Your pants are really tight, sir.
Yes.
And your balls are fucking giant.
Look up. Doing the tie-dye. Holy shit.
Yeah, you have giant balls.
Okay.
Jesus, this kid's
all right,
bag.
Well, that's a nice observation, too.
Wow.
Unlike Omar, though, you know, this is, of course, completely filthy. You guys remember Dr. Dirty, John?
Yes, we know.
Do
I
we not remember
Omar,
Dr. Dirty?
They'll have an opportunity to purchase.
Oh, my
Kevin
God.
Presents,
I said
John
interesting. Anyone have anything interesting to say? What's Pat doing here? What are we supposed to do? We Fit today or some shit?
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
No,
sorry.
Wait, you guys got a Wii Fit already?
Yeah, we were going to do a Wii Fit with a bunch of people that are completely out of shape. Like, Pat from Unaki. Come here, Pat. Grab a mic. He was in the Nathan's.
How did you get a Wii Fit? I've been like, they're like,
no shit. You know what? You say it on the air. You go, I need a Wii Fit.
I need a Wii Fit.
They pop up. There you
fit.
Go. Michael needs a fucking Wii Fit.
You're
get
damn
him one.
Right.
My
I'm wearing my workout clothes.
Yeah, Pat from Unaki is, he has been, how many years running have you been in the Nathan's Hot Dog
Eating? Last 4 years.
Last 4 years.
Yes.
He doesn't really come in fucking good. He's really bad at it. But he qualifies, which is, you know, big.
I get to the big show.
Yeah. He gets to the big show and doesn't wear shirts that promote the radio show.
You're not allowed
to. But everyone else is allowed to wear fucking costumes.
You can't promote anything,
though.
Is that
you crying?
Yeah.
That was actually whimpering.
My
soul
crying.
Yeah.
Let's go
it was whimpering.
Whimpering.
Pat's got a hell of a life. He lives in a trailer right at the end of the runway at, where is it, Teterboro?
Yeah. I got evicted from down at the river.
Oh, Christ! Wow, did you
down by the river?
Oh, here's that joke.
Back goes Griffey, looking up. Oh. It's out of here, or is it? No, it's off the wall.
Oh, shit! I thought it was gonna be a
damn.
And then it.
Yeah.
It's like a Neil Young song and Chris Farley, and I just
Pat's skinny fat. Isn't that funny? Like, look at his legs.
Pat is just, he's like, he's sexy fat. Like, he's happy with his body weight. But you see
him, I tip over a lot.
But you were dropping. He was a pretty good dancer. He was dropping it.
Oh,
like,
yeah,
it was,
yeah. Well, that's what they know him for, dancing and vomiting eggnog.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, fucking... you were supposed to do Wii Fit, though.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Right. I was going to get a headband, wristbands. Oh, I was really going to get a lap band.
Wow, are you bombing? You are tanking. And yeah, so you're all set up for it and everything with the let's get physical wear.
Yeah.
Only you have two breasts.
Hey.
All right. It was
yes.
Really inappropriate.
It was
wrong with you, dude.
Yeah.
Cruel. It's not accurate.
I know. I'm.
That's
I
all right.
Oh, God. I'm on my little man tit every now and then.
Yeah. Right. All right. Enough of you, Pat. What about Big A? Quickly, Big A. What were you here for? The same thing. You're gonna do.
You can't do the Wii Fit. Too big.
What?
Yeah, I was here to do the Wii Fit.
Yeah?
You tell me I'm so fit.
What the fuck are you saying?
What did you say?
Because it was vertical.
Come up, Andrew. Come up. You're way back there.
Yeah, you're wearing, I see you're wearing stripes to make yourself look thinner. That's good. You look like a beach ball trying to bust out of jail. That's kind of, I don't know. Yeah, but you were here for the Wii Fit. Okay. And are you going to... Are you gonna hang out for? Are you hanging out for Ron?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Oh.
Dude, you need to lose the sweater. That shirt, that Hawaiian shirt, is crazy. I
yeah, that's
that.
Nuts.
That's
wow.
A nice shirt.
There now you're sporting. Oh, no, you know, there you go.
There you go.
Hide your balls.
That's right. It's my Jimmy Buffett shirt. It's
5 o'clock. More like, no, I almost said Jimmy Buffet. Yeah, back down.
All right, that's pretty good.
I love Jimmy Fit.
Would you?
Absolutely.
Is that what the construction crew said? We fit his balls in these pants? Yeah.
I bet you he does it on purpose, too. Like, he probably stretches his balls out and then rubber bands them tightly just so people comment on them and girls like them.
They're actually.
So, Andrew, what were you saying?
Yeah, Andrew. What were you trying to say?
He kind of looks like a successful you.
Yeah, there is something there. There's definitely something there. The brother you have to take care of your whole life. Yeah. Big A, so what happened? You were here for Wii Fit.
Yes.
Yeah. Did you think you had a chance at getting one of the better scores? No?
No.
Hey, what are you doing tonight? It's Friday. Any parties going on? Any message board parties or
planning on going to Persephone to see Dustin Diamond.
Are you shitting me?
Persephone to see Dustin Hyman?
Dustin Diamond was Screech from Saved by the
Bell.
Are
you really going to Persephone to see Dustin Diamond?
I want to see the train wreck, that's what.
Where is he performing?
At
my house.
Where is he performing? Quickly, where is he? Where? Andrew, where? Oh. Andrew, Persephone, where? What's the place? What place? Andrew, where?
Place is... Oh, man.
Andrew. Oh, what's the name of that place? Andrew, where is it?
Hotel,
No, but where?
Rwanda?
Yeah.
I
the Overlook?
The Overlook, yeah.
Andrew's stance is so fucking wide. Looks like he's made out of cardboard.
It's very. He needs a wide stance. Close. You don't put a small foundation on a giant building.
Well, look at this. Look at Pat.
Yeah, look at him.
He looks like a fucking 9-year-old going to fucking school from the waist down.
Yeah.
Hey.
Ooh, wow. You just can't get one out, can you? All right. Why would you see Dustin Diamond in Persephone? There's no other fucking comics in Manhattan on a Saturday, a Friday night that you can go see? Who's like down at Caroline's or something? You have something going on with Dustin Diamond? Like,
oh, no.
Do you want to go, be his friend or something?
Actually,
you owe him money?
I'm supporting my friends at JJ Comedy. JJComedy.com.
Oh, wow. Those poor bastards. How are you supporting your friends there by...
Is it JJ Comedy or is it just J and you said it twice?
JJ.
No, no, it's JJ Comedy.
JJ Comedy.
You're going to hang out for a Ron and Fez? Or a...
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, okay. You've kind of been outshined by fucking Weirdo there, who does his little...
yeah, exactly.
Bad fucking rapping. What's his name? Crazed. Yeah, Crazed.
Who?
Oh, you don't acknowledge him?
Oh. I heard he was talking bad about you, Anthony.
He always talks a little smack that, about me.
I would never do that.
That's good. Yeah, okay.
Someone talking smack about you?
At least you're not, at least you're not googly-eyed like him.
Ooh. No, I'm not.
He is quite the weirdo. You see him on, he comes on Pal Talk every so often and just gets lambasted.
Yeah.
Until he's got to leave.
Yeah. He's a kook.
Yeah. Yeah. Get out of there. Attractive girls are the only thing that should ever be on Pal Talk. For me and Jim, it's like eBay.
That's right.
Pal Talk.
Pull your cock out and see who bites. You wave it in the camera. Pal Talk.
All right, enough for rambling. Yeah, I'm not going to go to a quarter after. Fuck you, people. It's Friday. I'm going to party. Oh, what do you got there, Halifax?
I want to thank Jimmy for turning me on to The Wire. So I think it's a fantastic series. I loved it. I just finished season 5.
Oh, good.
But I got a question for Michael. Did you keep your jacket from the show?
Yes, I did, actually.
Oh.
Yeah, I did. And the producers, they put it in this airtight frame box kind of thing. And they put on the years that Omar lived with Omar Devon Little, 2002,
oh, shit.
2005, or 8, whatever. Yeah.
And it's funny because we were very similar. You know, I have my sweater from Lucky Louie as well, but nobody put it in a case. Pamela mailed it to me in a box. She got the sweaters in here. Yeah,
and it wasn't actually dated. They just put a clock on the bottom with great. The time.
A flame clock, right?
Exactly. 8:15, 8:30. 15 minutes are up, jizz bucket.
Silence, you got. I got a die-cast metal Torgasm logo to hang around my neck.
Oof. Why not? You're like something hanging around Dane's.
I like
he goes, yeah, I have a 300-pound albatross.
I don't like this. Just as much as a coattail jumper. Dice, O&A, fucking Colin, back to O&A, over to Louis, back
Jimmy's
to
a success a hopscotch player.
Hey, I'm a bullfrog on a bunch of lily pad coattails. I'll fucking hop from one to the other forever. What do I care?
Yeah, that's right.
Exactly. Mm. But I would say, how about a nice hand for our guest, the great Michael K. Williams.
I like when a guest can hang out and just have fun with us for the whole show. It's fantastic, man.
This is the greatest, one of the greatest radio stages I've ever been in, man. Just, I've never seen with the audience.
It's fun, right?
Yeah, it's just hanging out. Fun, you know? Hanging out, bullshitting, and that's pretty much what this show is. We don't know what we're doing on a daily basis.
And that's what it should be.
Well, as long as the bosses think we prepare, we're okay.
Well, you know, you called to wish me a happy birthday.
Yeah.
That was fucking... we got you on the phone. That was great. Yeah. And it was supposed to be a big surprise. But then Roland. Where's Roland?
Yeah, Roland.
Before we wrap this up.
Blew the whole thing.
There he is.
Here he comes.
Roland.
There's Roland.
You said that Michael was a difficult guy to interview.
No, I did not say that.
No, he didn't say that. But he said, like, the day when Michael.
Lying.
I am lying. But the day Michael called in for my birthday, it was a big surprise. And Roland goes, well, Michael can't call in until after 9. I'm like, good.
Oh, great. Thanks. Yeah, blew the surprise.
Yeah.
Do you think if Al Qaeda cut his head off, they play volleyball with it?
It's just they'd probably eat out of it.
Or like it would be one of those comedy clips where they'd cut it off and it would roll away, and they'd be going, "It's rolled."
It's so scary. Movie.
It's so round. It just—I'm not saying it's bad looking.
They'd probably
I'm just saying it's very round.
They'd wear it on holidays.
That was a damn good one.
Roland
didn't think so. Nothing wrong with the choke bomb.
Yeah.
Roland would never do that.
Roland's got a very violent side.
Yeah, he's a psychopath. He's our sweet, mild-mannered booker and a psychopath.
It's the quiet ones that'll get you.
Always.
He's crazed.
Yep.
He's insane.
What up, bird?
Look, we're bailing on Line of the Day. I could give a shit. You know, I think everybody shared in Line of the Day. But we must thank, of course, Carbonite.com. You want to back up your hard drive? Go to Carbonite.com. You can't just have your computer and not back up your hard drive and be like Anthony and lose a bunch of pictures when your hard drive takes a shit.
And you want to get hard. Carbonite. You need your pictures to
Get
up the hard drive so you can get hard.
Lots of hard. Nice. You don't want to lose those pictures. No, you fucking... No. you know, broke the law to get.
Exactly, because they grow up and you can't photograph them anymore.
You know, nice photos, nice footage of your coffee table there. You
right,
know,
the coffee
those,
table.
Those are nice family memories, you know?
Yeah, family.
My gray coffee table.
Gray coffee.
I don't even want to think of your gray balls.
Like dead skin.
And two quick plugs. I'll be at the Wilbur Theater for the third show Friday, November 15th. I'm only doing one show that night. Tickets are on sale now. The Saturday shows are sold out. And of course, Michael K. Williams is in Spike Lee's new movie.
The Miracle of St. Anna comes out in theaters everywhere September 26th. Be there. Get that history.
A week from tonight. And and of course, The Wire is on DVD. I think it's the greatest series I've ever seen.
Got to thank Michael Chiklis and Dane Cook also.
Yes.
And Michael for coming in. Dane for calling.
Good show. Your song can be found on YouTube. What's it called?
It's called The Mary O. Remix.
Mary O. Remix. It's not on YouTube yet, though.
I think so. I'm not sure, but we'll find
out. How about iTunes?
Check.
I think iTunes, yeah.
Okay, go to iTunes and look for it. Just Google Omar. You'll find it.
Bobby, any plugs?
Yeah,
plugs?
Go to my MySpace.com/RobertKellyLive, and I got the October 24th Wilbur Theater. I have one show.
Okay.
And maybe not even that.
Yes, you'll have a show. Bobby's very funny.
Well, I didn't want to do three, but the first two were sold out. What am I going to do? Not do a third one?
Oh. Ooh, just rub that in.
Oh, Jesus.
Can't help it.
Also, too, if it's okay, if I can leave my website, MichaelKennethWilliams.com.
MichaelKennethWilliams.com.
Holla at your boy.
Check it out. All right. Thanks, man. And audience, thank you so much. Always a pleasure to have you in.
In the building.
It's Friday. Let's start drinking.
Bye.
It's Friday.
Look, he started to touch me. He started to grab me. I told him to stop. He didn't stop. I hit him back. And then he got really angry. He pushed me out of the car.
You want, fucko? You want some? Huh?
What are you doing?
Fuck! I broke my knee, man! Fuck! Swear my fucking mother, if you touch her again, you're dead!
Water. Hold my hand, man. I gotta squeeze some.
Fuck!